Good morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting of 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business this morning is a decision to take items 5 and 6 in private. Are members happy to do so? Thank you. So our next item of business is our second evidence session considering the general principles of the Bankruptcy and Diligence Scotland Bill. Today we will hear from Money Advice and debtor representatives, and I welcome Sarah Jane Dunn, Policy Manager for Financial Health with the Citizens Advice Scotland, and we're joined online by Becky Stacey, Senior Research Officer, Money and Mental Health Policy Institute. As always, if members and witnesses can keep their questions and answers as concise as possible, that would be helpful. First of all, maybe come to Becky. So, Becky, just to set some of the context for the bill, do you as an organisation identify people facing more problems with finances and with debt? And you'll know there was a recent Parliament report called Robbing Peter to Pay Paul, and that looked at some of these issues. Could you give us an idea of what the current situation is?
Yeah, absolutely. And thank you very much for inviting us to give evidence today. So, the Money and Mental Health Policy Institute is a research charity dedicated to breaking that vicious link between having a mental health problem and struggling financially. And when we think about the context of the relationship between the two, we know that people with mental health problems are 3.5 times more likely to be in debt. And that also half of people who are in problem debt are experiencing a mental health problem. And the more severe people's mental health problems, the greater it is that they are likely to be struggling with their finances. So a piece of protection that we campaigned heavily to be brought into place in England and Wales when the standard moratorium was introduced there was this mental health crisis breathing space, which was really important to recognise that those with mental health problems are going to face additional difficulties with their finances, and that some of those common symptoms associated with a mental health problem is going to mean they're really going to struggle to keep up with bills and payments and undertake quite simple financial management tasks. So we were really instrumental in calling for that protection to be in place, which is a great scheme, but we're really keen to see the lessons and learnings from its implementation down here in England and Wales to be incorporated into the implementation of a mental health moratorium in Scotland.
Thank you. And Sarah Jane, if I come to you, if you want to reflect on the previous committee's report, the Robbing Peter to Pay Paul, and give us an idea and a kind of impression of where we are at the moment in terms of people experiencing financial problems in Scotland.
Certainly. So, as you know, the Citizens Advice Network across Scotland covers 59 bureaus. And as a former money advisor myself, I was actually instrumental in working with the committee on the Robbing Peter to Pay Paul and bringing lived experience and hearing the voices of people who are in problem debt, poverty and struggling with their mental health. And as Becca pointed out there, one in two people in problem debt are also struggling with their mental health. Now, in the current landscape with the cost of living crisis, we are seeing people's budgets and household incomes being stretched beyond breaking point. And that is having a significant impact on people's mental well-being. But also those who have severe mental illness, as Becca had pointed out as well, they're already struggling. And that was before the pandemic and before the cost of living crisis. But they also struggle with the likes of being able to communicate with their creditors or with their priority bills. So if they were struggling with, say, their council tax, for example, which we see as being one of the highest debts that come to our network. And in fact, in July this year, it reached its peak. Somebody with mental health problems would struggle to actually communicate with their local council. And we know that council tax recovery is one of the harshest points of recovery. So they can see their debt triple almost within a month. And then they are then having to deal with that on top of the fact that they're severe mental health issues. And what we're hearing across our network is this is getting worse and worse and worse. But what is happening is that money advisors don't necessarily have the tools in their toolkit to deal with it. And the mental health moratorium could be the thing that could help them deal with this situation. Because when you have a client who has mental health issues or severe mental illness, dealing with their debt is the last thing on their mind and the last thing they're actually able to do. They need to focus on their mental health recovery first. And that is where the mental health moratorium could be a very significant tool for a money advisor, because it means that that allows that person to get their mental health at a stage where they are then able to discuss their debts and decide what options they want to go down. And as I said, the cost of living crisis is having a significant impact across all households, but those with severe mental illness, it is almost, as Rebecca was saying, 3 and 4 times worse for somebody who also has mental health problems.
Okay, thank you. Now, Sarah Jane, so the this bill, you've talked a lot about the mental health moratorium, and that is kind of the key policy area in this bill. But there are other campaigners who are suggesting the bill should be more robust at this stage. There should be more happening within the debt area. Mike Daly this week has talked about, I think Alan McIntosh has done research into wage arrestments, and we did see an increase in savings, bank arrestments. The threshold was increased, they're arguing there should be an increase to that threshold for wages. There's other campaigners arguing for more measures to be taken, recognising the cost of living crisis you've spoken about. Do you think that's a fair assessment of the bill? Do we need to see, while largely the bill has been welcomed, do we need to see more happening at this stage, or are you content with the government's proposal, which is this will be in the next part of the review?
It's one of those difficult things because I can see the arguments on both sides. And as I said, as a former money advisor, when you're seeing people struggling now, you obviously want action to happen now. However, at the same time, we have to be careful that we don't end up having unintended consequences. And by bringing things in certainly too early or rushing to bring things in. That being said, I do think there are certain things not necessarily need to be brought in by this bill, but should be certainly looking at to bring in as soon as possible and can be brought in through secondary legislation, such as the like, for example, of the reducing the reapplication periods of the minimum asset procedure bankruptcy. So at the moment, it sits at 10 years before you can reapply for a MAP. And we are now seeing many clients who are unable to reapply for the shorter, better bankruptcy for them because of this 10-year limit. And we would say reducing that down to 5 years so it matches full administration bankruptcy would mean that we'd be able to help a lot of people who are struggling and who shouldn't be going into a full administration bankruptcy just simply because they've had to reapply for debt resolution. Due to the fact that it's probably not their own fault, the fact that we've had to live through a COVID pandemic and a cost of living crisis, we are seeing more people with priority debt and more people who are struggling to just pay their actual bills. They're not taking out lavish, you know, holidays or going, you know, running up credit cards. In fact, if they're using credit cards, it's to pay their bills. So things like that could be done, but it can be done through secondary legislation. I think what this bill is good at is focusing on the mental health moratorium. That is desperately needed, and we don't have that enforced in order to do through secondary legislation. And I think if we were to put too much into this bill, we could end up losing that focus. And as someone who's been working tirelessly on the mental health moratorium for 3 years, it would be good to see it come into fruition as soon as possible.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Kevin Shute, did you request?
Yeah, thank you. And thank you very much for all of that, Ms Dunn. Obviously, you've highlighted the difficulties that there have been over the past few years, what with the COVID pandemic and the current cost of living crisis. And there's no doubt that that's had a major impact on folks' mental health as well as on their finances. And you talked about using secondary legislation there. Is there a danger that if we were to put too much into primary legislation, that we would lose the flexibility that has been required to meet the demands of the likes of COVID and the current cost of living crisis?
That is a fantastic point to put, Mr. Stewart, and that's one I would actually agree with. I think it's certainly a lesson that we should be learning, as Becca was suggesting, from our counterparts down south. They put a lot of the respite and the mental health crisis breathing space into primary legislation, and what that means is that when changes are needed and needed dramatically quickly, it's actually very difficult to do so. So that again is almost the beauty of this bill, and the fact that it's providing an enabling power to the accountant of bankruptcy to be able to bring in secondary legislation that covers regulations of how the mental health crisis moratorium would work up in Scotland. And I think what is good about that is almost reflective of what we do in consumer credit. So when something is to be changed in consumer credit, like for example the recent consumer duty, a bill is brought into place and it gives the Treasury a chance to put a policy statement out, and it's usually an enabling power. It then passes to the FCA to put out and, you know, drive out the principles of business and the rules and regulations that then will follow from that. And it's almost kind of reflective to me of that type of process. And the beauty of that means that when we bring something in like this into regulations, for example, the eligibility criteria, which I know can be quite a sticking point, especially because it might look like we've got a narrow scope to begin with, it means that as we look at things like the Scottish Mental Health Law Review recommendations coming into force, the recent mental health strategy that has just been announced, and the delivery plan, which is still to be brought into place, when they start to work in practice, we can learn lessons for that. And that means that we can then take those lessons, and if we need to adapt the mental health moratorium regulations, we can do so quickly. And I think what we learn from COVID, certainly as you pointed out, we need to be able to be reactive sometimes. And if we put this heavily into primary legislation, that would stop us from doing that.
So great points from you there. And you talked about the mental health review and the Lord Scott report, which is huge, shall we say. I'm probably one of very few folks that have read it cover to cover more than once because of previous role. But, you know, there are going to be legislative changes there which are obviously going to have a lot of good coming out of them. But also, if we were to put too much into primary legislation, that may lead to a lot of bad. Do you think, as a former money advisor yourself, that you and your colleagues are listened to enough when it comes to the formation of legislation? And do you think that you guys should play a part in terms of the formation to create secondary legislation that is flexible enough to deal with the challenges and changes that we have seen in recent times?
I have to say, yes, certainly over the last few years, and I think it's working together during the COVID pandemic, we were right at the forefront of working with Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government in terms of discussing changes to primary legislation, for example, the changes to the moratorium periods and increasing it to 6 months. And we were listened to, and I do feel that we are continued to be listened to. But yes, it is so important to have the voices of money advisors and those on the front line, especially as we are able to, you know, talk about the real life experiences of our clients. You know, we sit in a room with somebody whose whole life has fallen apart, and, you know, I've had clients who have been suicidal. I've lost clients to suicide, and it is a very difficult job that we do. But it's a job that we do because we want to help people. And we want to see them be able to become debt free. So I think it's definitely fundamentally important to have money advisors' voices at the heart of whatever we do, especially when it's looking at things that provide tools to their toolkit, because unless you know how it works in practice and how it's going to work in practice, then we could end up bringing in something that then is counterproductive.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. So, Sarah Jane, you might be able to give us an insight into when any future changes to bankruptcy reforms are going to come forward, because the government have given us a fairly technical bill. It does have the mental health moratorium, the rest is quite technical. And, you know, you've talked about the 10-year limit for minimum asset process bankruptcy, and as I've mentioned, there's issues around arrestment of wages and other areas. Do you have an understanding of when the government are going to bring forward, whether it's talking about secondary legislation or policy in this area? Because you've talked about the pressure on people now, so when are we actually going to see the other reforms that people are...
As far as I'm aware, with the mental health moratorium, so I was actually part of the working group that worked on the recommendations that have gone to the minister. And as far as I am aware, we're hoping to have a wider consultation, hopefully in the next few, as soon as the bill allows us to do so. In terms of the other changes to secondary legislation, as far as, again, as I'm aware, that the accounting and bankruptcy is to do this as soon as we're able to possible and laying the regulation changes that they need to do. So, for example, the biggest one that we're looking forward to in terms of is the changes to the protected trust deeds and making the protocol that was brought in as a voluntary measure as a mandatory measure, and I think as soon as they can bring that in, the better, especially with the fact that we have issues of many protected trust deeds being missold. In terms of the example that I brought with the minimum asset procedure bankruptcy, that is something that we are actually calling for alongside our colleagues at Step Change, Christians Against Poverty and Money Advice Scotland. We've not actually been able to get guarantees of it, but it's something that we've suggested that needs to be happening before the stage three review. In terms of the stage three review, as far as, again, as I'm aware, we have just announced the independent chair who will be looking at taking that forward, and there's a ministerial meeting next week, so I'm hoping that we'll get some further details. As much as possible, I would say they're trying to go as fast as they possibly can, and I think that's, again, the need for this bill to be brought into force as soon as possible, because then it allows us to focus on the detail that needs to be kind of hashed out and wider consulted upon, because obviously the recommendations from the working group that Becca and I were part of are just that, they're just recommendations. We would obviously want to get the wider Money Advice and mental health sector to give us their insights and views as well.
Okay, thank you. These are issues that we will take up with the Minister once we have him at committee. Colin Smith, be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to our panel. Can I kick off with some questions specifically on the mental health moratorium, particularly the eligibility criteria, which you mentioned earlier, Sarah Jane. Now, the Mental Health Moratorium Working Group recommend only people who are subject to compulsory mental health treatment should be eligible for the moratorium. Now, that's quite a narrow definition, as I think you mentioned, Sarah Jane. It's obviously narrower than the criteria in England and Wales, which covers non-compulsory crisis treatment. I mean, is that definition that's been recommended by the working group wide enough to support those people that are facing mental health challenges when it comes to debt?
I can understand, obviously, your resonance. Certainly somebody who, as I said, has been working for the mental health moratorium for the last 3 years. I was actually part of the accounting and bankruptcy working groups that recommended that we got the mental health moratorium, and then part of the mental health moratorium working group. And we certainly, as the working group, rigorously looked at all sides to see how, what definitions and what eligibility criteria we could have. And we were lucky to have Dr. Roger Smythe from the Royal College of Psychiatrists, who were able to kind of give us an insight into how mental health sector work. And that's how we came up with this definition and this eligibility criteria of compulsory treatment orders. Now, compulsory treatment orders can actually be for quite long-standing conditions, and it's the compulsory part that is under the treatment. But treatment can cover anything from talking therapies to psychotherapy to CBT, and it can be inpatient and outpatient. It can be in the community. So it does, is actually a lot wider than you would first think. Now, obviously, you're saying that down south, they have non-compulsory treatment covered, but actually what they focus on is mental health crisis treatment. So it's slightly different to what we're trying to focus on up here. And we've tied it to the Mental Health Care and Treatment Plan Act, because it's very difficult. We would love to open up the wide net, but we need to make sure that this works in practice. And that, again, has come back to what I was saying earlier about the fact the beauty of it being in secondary legislation means that as things such as the Mental Health Law Review changes come into practice, which will change things like compulsory detention and move it to in-care community treatment, we can start to see how that then works in practice and in alignment with Money Advice and the Money Advice sector. And as we understand those changes, we can then look and revisit the eligibility criteria under the Mental Health Moratorium, build that evidence base and widen it out. And that means that it's fair and balanced for all parties, not just the person who's got troubles with their mental health problems and their money, but also creditors, the economy, society, local communities. It makes sure it works for everybody. So it might be a narrow scope to begin with, but that doesn't mean it's going to be that forever. And it's certainly not something that we will be resting our laurels on. We will be making sure that it continues to work for those in practice. But we do kind of have to almost take our time with it.
You mentioned earlier that the timescales for the moratorium, or the wider moratoriums that was extended to 6 months, and I think my colleagues are probably going to have some specific questions on that. But there's obviously a fear that if that's reduced, and we go back to the previous timescale, that then means that a lot of people who do have mental health problems will struggle if they're not covered by this criteria. I mean, how many people do you think will be covered by having a compulsory mental health treatment by the moratorium if they have debt issues? I mean, have you done any modelling on, when you discussed the criteria, what sort of numbers you were talking about?
Well, we, unfortunately, it's not possible to assess how many numbers are likely to then be in debt, but we can extrapolate the fact that there was last year, I think there was roughly around 13,000 compulsory treatment orders across Scotland. And, you know, so if we were to take that as a number, we could say that might not necessarily sound like a lot, but again, it's about looking at the fact that we need to bring this mental health moratorium in to begin with, and because of the changes that are happening in the mental health sector, we don't want to widen the net too far. That ends up meaning that those who might have mental health problems and might have a severe mental illness, but it's manageable and they could be able to be making decisions with their debt, are not put into the wrong moratorium. Now, that is why we're having things like the money advisor being involved and other aspects to it, because the idea of the mental health moratorium is to have what we would say two separate periods. So period one would look at the recovery of their mental health, so allowing them that time, space and compassion to look at the fact that they need to just focus on their mental health recovery. The second additional period, which we've always suggested aligned with the standard moratorium, then allows them to focus on their debts. Now in Scotland we have a standard moratorium, which yes, at this present moment in time is 6 months, and that is to reflect the current economic context and the fact that we're still in the midst of a cost of living crisis. But if that does get reduced, it will not go back to 6 weeks. It will likely go to 12 weeks or more, because that is what we've discussed previously in the COVID recovery bills and the legislation and the consultations that we had around that. But that could be sufficient enough time for somebody even with a mental health problem to deal with their debts, because we have that standard moratorium. But the purpose of the mental health moratorium is to separate that out, is to say the first part is to look at your treatment, to make sure that you are in a position to then deal with your debts. And that's why we are calling for the additional period to be aligned with the standard moratorium, to allow that period of time to focus on their debts. And down south, the mental health crisis briefing space only affords 30 days. And as somebody who's worked with people with severe mental illness, who's been in and out of treatment and who have came out of psychiatric hospital, for example, or outpatient community care, when they come out of that, they are in no position to suddenly deal with their debts. So they need to make sure that the period that they get for that additional protection is sufficient enough to get them back on their feet in terms of their housing and their bills, but also then being able to make that decision around their debts and what solutions they want to go down. 30 days is not sufficient. So that is why we argued for it to be aligned with the standard moratorium. I don't think the standard moratorium will ever go back to 6 weeks. I could be wrong, but I am certainly not something that the money advice sector would call for. We would want a minimum of 12 weeks, and that should be sufficient for people to then deal with their debts. But it's about having that balance of what is mental health moratorium trying to achieve. It's allowing that time, space and compassion for somebody to focus on their mental health before they deal with their debts.
Which obviously could still be quite challenging within a 12-week period if somebody has a mental health problem. Can I bring Becca in? Becca, you mentioned the Breathing Space Scheme in England and Wales and the organisation's involvement in developing that. I mean, what lessons can we learn from that in terms of the eligibility criteria in Scotland?
So I think the key lessons that we take from England and Wales relate a bit more to implementation necessarily than to the eligibility criteria. So while, as Sarah Jane said, with the working group, the decision was made that focusing on those with the more severe mental illness, it's better to capture those potentially with compulsory treatment under the Mental Health Care and Treatment Act. I think money and mental health would probably suggest ultimately that both those receiving compulsory and voluntary treatment should be eligible. But as Sarah Jane said, the key aspect here is the fact that through secondary legislation, if upon implementation and after reasonable time, it's been identified that a wider net needs to be cast to ensure that those who would benefit from its protections can be eligible for it, then that is a necessary step that should be taken. I guess the lessons really that we would take from England and Wales relate to its underutilisation. So we know that in 2018, 23,000 people who were in hospital for their mental health problem were in problem debt. So there's a huge group of people who are in need of this support, but In the first 22 months of its implementation, so that's from May 2021 to March 2023, only 2,075 mental health crisis breathing space applications have been made down in England and Wales. So that's a severe underutilization compared to the Treasury's estimates of 27,500 mental health crisis breathing space applications in 2021 to 22. And our argument isn't so much that it's an issue of eligibility. We agree that people who are in mental health crisis care should be eligible. It's more to do with the fact that it's not routinely offered to people in England and Wales. There's a lack of awareness about the scheme among healthcare professionals and mental health professionals, and also challenges whereby approved mental health practitioners are the only professionals who can sign off someone's eligibility to that criteria. So for us, those are the learnings that we'd really like to see Scotland take on board. And that's why, as part of the mental health moratorium working group that Sarah Jane and I have been part of, we've really called for a routine offer to be made to people who are eligible for a mental health moratorium, for a wider range of professionals to be able to sign off someone's eligibility, and for the moratorium essentially to be developed in conjunction with healthcare professionals and money advisors so that awareness can be really developed from the beginning of the implementation process.
That's very helpful. But in terms of the eligibility criteria that you mentioned, that you would support a slightly wider definition of that criteria. I mean, what would that definition entail? Would that be the same definition as England and Wales? Or, I mean, are there particular challenges about how you then define something? Compulsory treatment is quite easy to define, but I suppose widening it makes it more challenging.
Exactly. And I think that was the point that we as a working group landed on, was it's especially for that, bringing it into play, finding existing treatment that is easy to identify eligibility through. And I think that's a really important part of the recommendations the working group put forward. I guess, as Sarah Jane mentioned, the context is slightly different, whereby in England and Wales, it's anyone receiving mental health crisis care. And that can be compulsory or voluntary. And we would ultimately like people receiving similar levels of care with a mental health crisis in Scotland, be that voluntarily or under compulsion, to also be eligible. But I think the key point is that those who are, as Sarah Jane said, receiving it through compulsion are going to be the ones with the more severe mental illness. So that approach will capture those with the most acute needs and the ones who are probably going to be or will be the most likely to benefit and be in demand of these protections the most. But it's just having that built in recognition that, similarly within England and Wales, this is a new scheme, and upon implementation, if it's felt by mental health professionals or by money advisors that those who are needing that support aren't able to receive it, being proactive and responding to that, and then bringing in again mental health professionals like Roger Smythe, who Sarah Jane mentioned that we've been working with on the working group, to identify where else under the legislation could we capture a slightly broader remit of people if necessary.
Challenge for by Brian Whittle.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning, Beth and Sarah Jane. Thank you for joining us today. If I can, I want to carry on the theme of questioning that Colin started around the mental health moratorium and how we can make it as effective as possible, and what are the potential challenges. Sarah Jane, you mentioned the role, the really vital role of money advisors, and you obviously have that direct experience yourself. Just a couple of questions around that. We know that. And you've alluded to the increase in need for money advisors. And I'm just wondering what your thoughts are around capacity of the money advice sector to actually meet potential demand for this. And what else needs to change alongside this legislation, or what else needs to be brought in to ensure that the money advisors have the support, the numbers and the resources to do this really, really important advising work?
I mean, I could probably talk at length about this, but I will try to be as concise as possible. But yes, you are correct in saying that obviously money advisors are very important, and especially in the bringing around the mental health moratorium. And effectively, we are what some would say a dying breed. We certainly do need an influx of resources and support that is needed for that. But saying that, still, the money advice sector in Scotland will meet the demand that's at the door, because we always have done and we always will do. But it would be good to see extra resources brought in. However, in terms of this, what I would say one of the things that we definitely need to do, and it has started already happening, is marrying the mental health support system with the money advice sector and actually working in conjunction. Now, prior to going to Citizens Advice Scotland and becoming the financial policy manager, I actually was running the mental health and money advice service in Scotland. And what I found as a money advisor and running this service, that was the more joined up that a money advisor was with a client's mental health support network, meant that things could get done quicker. It meant things like getting such as like the debt and mental evidence form, which is such a vital form in these situations, to be signed and used, and then being able to request things such as write-off from creditors is so valuable. And being able to know, for example, that if you were working with their carer or their support worker, or even in having conversations with psychiatrists and psychologists and CPNs, it meant that we were able to then use that information to then discuss things with creditors, especially priority creditors such as councils, where we're able to then kind of give a more better understanding of that client situation and their mental ability to be able to then deal with certain debts, for example. One of the things that we've been trying to do is, and calling for at Citizens Advice Scotland, is that joining up of mental health and money advice by embedding things like money advice in mental health settings, so working with local community teams, but also looking at training as well. So a lot of our money advisors in Citizens Advice Scotland have taken steps to make sure that they're very scared almost to have these conversations around mental health, because it takes a lot of understanding of how certain things like treatment or drug programs or medication can impact on somebody. For example, I had a client who was a paranoid schizophrenic and would take certain medication, and I knew that don't talk to them in the morning, because when they first take their medication, they weren't able to even talk. I then had to make sure that their appointments in the afternoon. But I only had that learning because I was working in a service that was dedicated to working with people with mental health and money problems. So we've obviously put training in place to give our money advisors that support. But at the same time, as Beck had pointed out, one of the reasons and one of the lessons that they've taken from down south is the fact we need to bring the mental health sector along with us. And they're equally worried at having discussions around money with clients. And now, under mental health care and treatment plans, there is now a requirement to discuss finances. But a lot of people who are in that world are almost scared that they're going to open a can of worms if they ask somebody about debt and financial worries. So training mental health sector or giving them resources to then be able to have those conversations is also fundamental. And one of the biggest things that have came out of is the Money and Pension Services Money Guiders programme. And we've been working a pilot down in NHS Borders where we've been using the Money Guiders programme to train mental health professionals in NHS Borders, but then also having them connected to the CAB network, so that if they did have a client or service user who did have financial problems and they did have these conversations, they were then able to warm refer that person onto money advice support. And that's where we need to also make sure the system behind it is connected as much as possible. And we can only do things by replicating things like the Money Guiders pilot that we did down in the NHS Borders across all 14 NHS boards in Scotland.
Thanks very much. And I think you make the point of the needs for connections into the whole piece, not just see the money advice as a single issue. We heard last week from people involved in the commercial money advice sector that they need to be involved in this as well. And I just wondered if you could say briefly what kind of relationship you've had or citizens advice sees with the commercial sector, and how is it that we make sure that there isn't a different approach, a different type of service being provided to people who seek support?
The commercial sector, we're almost a little bit lucky in the sense that with the Financial Conduct Authority, they have brought in certain rules and regulations that commercial firms have to follow, such as the vulnerability guidance that they must do. So somebody with a vulnerability characteristic, they have to make sure that their processes and procedures take account of that and treat customers fairly because it. And then just recently, they've just introduced the consumer duty. So you're almost there. The commercial sector is a little bit further ahead, I would say. The actual focus needs to be on the public sector and public sector debt. So things like government overpayments of benefits, HMRC debts, you've got council debts like council tax arrears, rent arrears. As I said before, council tax recovery is one of the harshest forms of recovery. You know, within a matter of a month, you could end up on your full council tax bill. And as somebody who's got severe mental illness, you've gone from not missing one payment of, say, £130 average council tax payment to now suddenly owing £1,300. Yeah. These are certain things that we need to bring into place, because the FCA heavily regulate the commercial sector, and because of that regulation we have seen improvements. Now, it's not perfect. There are certainly things that they need to do better, and we've brought out Sets Advice Scotland, and MAPS also brought out a version as well, but we brought out our mental health and money guidance, good practice guidance, and we're hoping to work with the commercial sector and public sector on improving how do we handle things like disclosure of mental health, and how can we support people with mental health and money issues better.
Thanks very much, Sarah Jane. Becca, if I could come to you, I suppose following on from that, a couple of questions just around the money and mental health and the thinking around the support that money advisors get and the potential. Last week I used the term gatekeeping. Have you experienced, is there any sort of experience of money advisors not referring or not supporting people in the way that we might wish, especially under the mental health moratorium, because they don't necessarily have the resources, the skills, the tools that they need. Do you have any experience of that from how things are operating elsewhere?
A big piece of research looking at some of the common challenges people with mental health problems can face to engaging with their advice. And I think the key point that came out of that was essentially money advisors are always going to want to do the best for their client, but naturally, because of some of the funding requirements or restrictions on them, they often don't have the time or the space to give to clients with mental health problems that they would like to. And I think that's often a frustration that they feel like they can't. For example, we know people with mental health problems are going to need longer appointment times probably when they're seeing money advisors. We know that they might need what was discussed written up afterwards due to difficulties with memory. We know that it might be that they need, instead of sort of one big advice slot, sort of smaller chunks to address the fact that they might struggle with their concentration. And I think a lot of that tailoring of money advice, it's not a lack of want from money advisors to provide that, it's a constraint issue due to the funding remits within which they're working. And as Sarah Jane was saying, I think what's really positive when you see processes that try and join up mental health services and money advice is that sort of understanding of the client group and their needs that you're working with become more embedded in part of the service that's being delivered. And I think a positive process in that is then better understanding how to respond to those people with mental health problems. But similarly to what Sarah Jane was alluding to, if there is that expectation that those people with more severe mental health problems in particular are going to have their needs met, that needs to be accompanied by an understanding from funders that more time is going to be needed to be provided by money advisors and a different sort of more holistic support facilitated, where it's not so much maybe on the quantity of people that you're able to see, but acknowledging the fact that that might be a lot more of an intense relationship and issuing of support.
Thanks. That's really helpful, Becca. Just a question on the role of who refers. So it's quite clear in the proposals that the application for the moratorium to apply will only go through a money advisor. Do you think that that's okay? Do you think that potentially could miss out people who would be eligible but haven't found a money advisor or can't for their mental health crisis reasons? Are we missing potentially people who will fall through the cracks here?
So I think the point to make and that we discussed and put forward with the working group is it's a money advisor who in that initial instance is going to be verifying that someone is unable or is going to be unlikely or able to pay their debts and almost sort of approve that someone is in the level of debt, or not even the level of debt, is eligible for this scheme. So it's less about someone having to go and physically or virtually access a money advisor. It's about, say, for example, if the route that they're coming through the mental health moratorium through is through their mental health professional, mental health officer, for example, the mental health officer would routinely offer that there is this protection in place if you are struggling with your finances and that's been identified as a contributor or an issue that is exacerbating your mental health problem or something that you're struggling with. That mental health officer or whichever mental health professional it is can then liaise with a money advisor who will verify the financial side of someone's debts and therefore be the second part of verifying someone's access to a mental health moratorium. So absolutely, I mean, the point that we'd made being an issue with the standard breathing space down in England and Wales is that that expectation that someone, when they are struggling with their mental health, to go and access a money advisor, which is how you have to access the standard mental health, the standard breathing space down in England and Wales, is unrealistic. And especially for people who are going to be in inpatient care, that's a complete barrier to access. So what we also have with the mental health crisis breathing space here is the same as what we as a working group have recommended. You need a debt advisor or a money advisor to verify someone's entry into that scheme, but it wouldn't be until that second period, once they have recovered or are in the process of recovering from their mental health problem, and that they are then in that sort of buffer period, that they are then going to be looking to ideally engage with a debt advisor, a money advisor, to implement a debt solution.
Thanks both. That's really helpful. And you've both, I think, indicated quite clearly the importance of post-legislative scrutiny in this to cover a whole range of different issues. But I'll leave it there.
Thank you.
I've got a very brief supplementary, if you don't mind, about Sarah's comments.
If it's brief.
You mentioned the council tax scenario and how often that puts a great deal of grief onto clients. Do we have examples of councils that do this better than others in Scotland? And would it be wise, in your opinion, to export that good practice right across the board?
Yes, that could give a very short answer. I know for a fact that the Minister has actually been visiting these areas. I know he visited Fife, for example. I always use Fife as a very good example. Another would be Falkirk and Dumfries and Galloway. They're all doing slightly different things, but they're certainly good practice that can be shared and was collated in the Improvement Services Collaborative Guide to a good practice for council tax, which we would really encourage councils to adopt, especially because it has been shown that when you adopt these good practices and you adopt these collection methods, it actually leads to better recovery. Money advisors will always try and prioritise council tax because it is a priority bill, and it's not a much, what we find, it's not much of people not wanting to pay, it's simply people cannot pay. And certainly our research that we recently released around the drivers of council tax, that was something that definitely called through. But just to point out, as Becca was saying, the fact that, you know, by having that routine question and having that routine offer built into the mental health moratorium will naturally as well build those links between mental health officers and mental health professionals with debt advisors. It means that it doesn't just, even though that it might be a debt advisor who completes the form and the mental health moratorium on behalf of that service user, they might not necessarily use that debt advisor when they come out of that moratorium. However, that debt advisor is aware of their case, and it's more likely, because that connection has been made, they will go and seek that debt advice. And that's a fundamental important. One other fact I would like to point out, though, is that most of the time, a standard moratorium is a money advisor that's making that application. It's not, even though it is available for the public to do so, it's very unlikely that Joe Public do apply for the standard moratorium on their own. So this would allow, by building in that routine questioning and allowing that, those both routes, if somebody goes through a money advisor first or goes through the mental health professional first, they are able to access this moratorium, but building those links between mental health sector and the money advice sector at the same time.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Brian Whittle to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I think just to move up, to move the conversation along from what my colleagues have been discussing before around, I'd like to discuss sort of the practicalities what we're discussing here. I mean, mental health is such a sliding scale, and what we're trying to do here is put it into almost a black and white box, if you like, about who is eligible here. And it strikes me that to get to that stage, you know, in terms of mental health, one, you have to recognise you have a mental health issue. Two, then you have to be prepared to go and ask for help. And we know that access to mental health help at the moment, mental health care, is, you know, difficult. We have an NHS under extreme pressure, especially mental health section of that. And then on top of that, you then have to access money advisors. So I'm wondering whether or not the decision in terms of who is eligible for this is more around what is practically capable, rather because of a limited resource, and whether or not we'll be missing a section of people here who actually should be within the moratorium.
And yeah, and as we've said, I think that's why we need that scrutiny of the once it's become implemented, because I think only then, once we actually have a system on which to play within, we will know what actually the true landscape looks like. At the moment, we don't have anything. So in actual fact, we're losing, lots of people are slipping through that net at this moment in time. And you are right, when someone is in that situation, you're expecting them to do this. But that is why we're trying to build a mental health moratorium process that wraps around them rather than expecting them to do it. And that's why we came on to such things as compulsory treatment orders. So somebody who's had under a compulsory treatment order and they're having their treatment plan decided, building that routine questioning in around their finances and seeing if they do actually have debts, that then triggers the mental health officer, not the client or the service user, to then liaise with the money advice sector and get in the mental health moratorium in place. That means that whilst that is running, the mental health officer can focus on getting working through that treatment programme with the service user. And the service user will have been placed under compulsory treatment order. And what is really good about our system, which is different to England and Wales, is the fact that we have a review process built into that system as well. So the mental health officer has to regularly go to tribunal to give reasons why that person has to be under compulsory treatment order. And if they then find that compulsory treatment is no longer needed, now that doesn't mean treatment's no longer needed, it's just the compulsory part of it. They may continue to have a treatment care plan, but they're no longer under a situation severity enough that needs the compulsory part of it. They can then notify certain bodies under that to say that the compulsion has been lifted off that treatment order. And what's good is that we can insert the likes of the counselling and bankruptcy. And what that does is that then flags to the money advisor who has put through the mental health moratorium that the compulsory treatment order part has ended. And that means that they're then moving into the additional period time. So let's use an example. We have a service user who goes into compulsory treatment. He goes, say they've went through it for 6 months. After 6 months, they're found out they no longer need that compulsory treatment. They may continue to have medication and doing other treatment that they do, but the compulsion part has ended. They're then, because of the system that's built in the review process, that is flagged up through the system to the counter and bankruptcy, which then through the moratorium system that is built, and we've got the likes of Basis and Eden and Astra already there, they then flag the money advisor. The money advisor can then contact the service user and say, we understand that you've got, you've came out of this part of it, you've got some debts here. We would like to start supporting you to deal with those debts. And this is, your moratorium period will continue for another 6 months or whatever the length of time is at that point. We would then like to take that time to build up that knowledge and start to look at your options around debt. That means that we're actually having that wraparound system around that client right from the get-go, and we're capturing them as we go. Now, there will be people that will slip through the net. We know that. Unfortunately, no system is ever going to be perfect, but it means that we can start to capture people. And as we build that evidence, as we hear from money advisors working in the sector or mental health professionals working in that field going, we're not capturing A, B and C because they're under this treatment, we can then start to move and reflect and change the regulations to suit that. But until we bring that into place, we won't be able to do that.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring Beck in here. I think my concern here is, are money advisors in a situation where they can take this work on? I mean, it almost seems to me is that, the way the system is set up is that if you're in a compulsory, mental health treatment order, then, this will kick in. But as we've discussed there, the way mental health works is not in a linear fashion. And it might be, for example, that the money advisor themselves have concerns about the client with which they're working with. Are we suggesting here that money advisors should have the capability of contacting mental health services to ask advice?
Yeah, and this was a really interesting conversation that we had as part of the moratorium working group, in the fact that it might actually be a debt advisor or a money advisor who is the first point of contact for an individual. And as Sarah Jane was saying, I think sometimes when you identify that someone is also really struggling with their mental health, then it might be that they are the ones to sort of, again, understand that they do need that wider wraparound support, and that for various reasons, a standard moratorium might not be suitable for them, I guess, particularly in the Scottish context, maybe because they're not in a position to keep up with payments and charges on debts. Therefore, that clause on interest and charges would be really key if that is part of the Scottish moratorium that's brought in place, or the fact that their mental health problem, through speaking to their wider network, is identified as being sort of episodic or recurrent, which is quite a common thing. And therefore, you know, this restriction that they can only apply for a standard moratorium once every 12 months is not going to be realistic. And it might be that they need to be able to apply for those protections more regularly, which is another reason why, as part of the working group, we called for no limit on how many times someone can apply for it. So, yeah, we did talk about the fact that it might be a money advisor who sort of identifies the need for that support. I think the point that we also did make, though, was that it always needs to be a mental health professional who determines whether someone meets the eligibility criteria, be that sort of compulsory treatment under the Mental Health Care and Treatment Act. And then obviously with the sort of authorization given by the individual, or if suitable and in place, a third party acting on behalf of that individual. So again, I think the more, as Sarah Jane was speaking to, that interaction between money advisors and mental health professionals exists, and that might in reality mean that sometimes that support has been instigated from a debt advisor or a money advisor initially, the more those interactions takes place, the better and the more supportive that wraparound support for that individual. And again, it's not about them then having to sort of be the one to instigate engaging with both sources of support. It's about that liaison happening on their behalf, essentially, by those who are involved in their care.
Thank you. A really helpful answer. I think if we look at what, from a practicality perspective, if can I put a scenario together here that, you know, the debt advisor recognises potential issue with a client and contacts mental health, and there is a delay, as there often is, in accessing that sort of mental health help. What happens in the interim, in that period? How do we deal with that period of time between the recognition there could be a problem and the diagnosis of the problem? What do we do with that?
Well, I think at that point, that's where the benefit of having the standard moratorium, because a person could have put, you could put a standard moratorium in place. It's a simple form, you fill it in, and then that kicks in during that diagnostic period, and then they can move into a mental health moratorium. Now, the only difference would be, obviously, as Becca was pointing, there are certain protections under the mental health moratorium that we have recommended as a working group, such as freezing interest and charges. However, there are other mechanisms that a money advisor can use, what I've already mentioned, which is the debt mental health evidence form. That has its own issues, and that's why we at Citizens Advice Scotland and others are calling for the debt mental health evidence form to be built into the mental health moratorium as a trigger for the mental health moratorium alongside any statutory form that might be recommended. And that is because a debt mental health evidence form can do more than the standard moratorium. It can request things such as debt write-off, and it can also request such things as interest and charges being frozen or other tailored support. So if I was a money advisor in that situation, that's how I would approach it. I would apply for the standard moratorium to make sure that they have at least some form of breathing space, but I'd also look to get the debt mental evidence form in place so that they can look at things like freezing interest and charges. However, a mental health moratorium would be the benefit. So once they are able to be eligible for that, apply immediately for the standard the mental health moratorium, because then that takes the pressure off the pedal. It means that they can focus on their mental health. These other options are dealing with debt. That's not dealing with our mental health, and we need this mental moratorium to give that recognition that what we need is a period of time for that person to go away, recover as best as they can, so that they're able to then come back and deal with their debt. The current tools that we have in our toolkit does not allow for that to happen. And as a money advisor who's had to support many difficult clients and many clients with severe mental illness, if we had had a mental health moratorium, the amount of support and good that could have came from that would have been astronomical, and it would have been such an important part of when I was working with clients. And as Becca was, you know, saying, the fact that money advice isn't a lack of want to support a client in that situation. It's sometimes we don't have what we need to do it. And as much as you might want to as a money advisor, if you don't have it, then you can't do it. Money advisors are crying out for the mental health moratorium. Now, as you say, it would be great if we could get a perfect system that works right off the bat. That would be amazing. But that's not how reality works. And sometimes it's better to start from a basic point and work our way out than to try and build that perfect system and not giving the support to now. That's just how I would see it.
Thank you. Very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll make some progress. We've got a few other questions, which I think will be focused more towards Sarah Jane. So I'll go over to Murdo Fraser to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Camina. Good morning. I'm sorry to Becca Stacey, but I think the questions we're going to ask are probably out with your remit. So I'll just direct them to Sarah Jane, and apologies. You're on your own for this, if that's all right. I just want to broaden the issues a little bit and look at some of the other things that are in the bill or what, mm-hmm. maybe what's not in the bill. And one of the issues we've picked up in taking evidence is this question of the minimal asset process bankruptcy. And as you know, there are currently rules that say an individual can only apply for that once every 10 years. And it's been suggested to us that this bill could be amended to say that rule should be relaxed. So I'm interested to get the perspective of Citizens Advice Scotland on that particular issue.
Certainly, and it's something that we are hoping, as I said, alongside others such as Step Change, Cushions Against Poverty, Money Advice Scotland, that we are calling for. Not necessarily needs to be in this bill. It could be something that done after the Bankruptcy and Diligence Act, because it's tied to the Bankruptcy and Debt Advice Scotland Act. So many. But it's something that we would say is needed. When the money advice, the minimum asset process bankruptcy was brought into play, the 10-year rule was seen as a way to mitigate against abuse and to see people to repeatedly go bankrupt. However, it failed to recognise what the purpose of the minimum asset process bankruptcy was, which is simply those who have no assets and cannot repay their debts can go into bankruptcy. And the full administration bankruptcy is to capture those who are able to make a contribution or have an asset. But then it added on this 10-year rule to say that you can only apply once every 10 years. And maybe at the time when it was brought in, it was just after the 2008 crash, when the landscape of debt was very different to what we have seen. But certainly due to the fact that the likes of us talked about the pandemic and the current cost of living crisis, people are falling into more and more priority debt. And that means it's debt that is beyond their control. We are seeing, certainly in Citizens Advice Scotland, certainly in Step Change and Christians Against Poverty, that one in two of our debt clients have a negative budget. That means they don't have enough income coming in to cover their bills. And it doesn't matter how much income maximisation a money advisor does, that has not changed. And it means that such as putting them into a bankruptcy for 12 months rather than a minimum asset procedure, which is 6 months, you're merely just extending the delay of them getting debt relief and debt help for something that is beyond their control and their fault. And we have put a paper together and presented it to the minister. But one of the things that was clear in the First Minister's recent speech was the fact that we're looking at to do as much as we can to be anti-poverty, to tackle poverty head on. And yet we have this arbitrary rule of 10 years that is stopping someone getting the right solution at the right time that is right for them. And we cannot see any argument of to why it needs to be 10 years. Now, we're not even asking it to be less. We're asking it to be the same as a full administration bankruptcy so that we can bring back those purposes that the minimum asset process is for people who have no assets, they have no income in which to make a contribution, but they need that debt relief. And the full administration bankruptcy is for those who are able to pay something towards their contribution, either through a contribution or through an asset. And that is what the minimum asset and the full administration bankruptcies need to be about. And having a 10-year rule does not do that.
Okay, thank you. I mean, that's a very, very clear answer. Do you think there are any risks at all in moving away from 10 years. And I asked the question in the context. I remember I was on the predecessor committee that dealt with the bankruptcy and diligence bill, and we looked at, I think that's what introduced the policy in the first place, and the 10-year rule. One of the issues that came up at that point, if I remember correctly, was concerns that those who have very low income and very low assets, if they weren't able to access mainstream lending in any form, then that left them in the hands potentially of the illegal loan shark sector. So do you think there might be some risk there if the 10-year rule was relaxed?
Not in that sense, no. And I don't actually think there would be any risk, simply because in order to access bankruptcy in Scotland, you have to have mandatory debt advice. So a money advisor, and I'll borrow a word that Maggie used earlier, is almost gatekeeped in the sense that there is a gatekeeper at that door, and that is a money advisor. A money advisor will never put someone into a bankruptcy unless it is the best solution for them, or it's an option that the client wishes to go down. But they will usually make sure that they are applying for bankruptcy, and it is used as a last resort. Actually, at the moment, a lot of money advisors are refraining to go down the statutory debt solutions route, either because the 10-year rule is stopping them, or because they recognise that bankruptcy isn't going to solve that person's problem, because 3, 6, 9 months down the line, they're going to be back into debt. So they're having to look at non-statutory debt solutions. So because a money advisor has to really do the application and go through that process, it almost removes the risk, because a money advisor needs to be a trusted professional in this discussion. And so we can either ask ourselves, do we trust our money advisors to follow the rules and do what they need to do to support clients and making sure they access the best solutions, or do we not? And the 10-year rule almost says to money advisors, we do not trust you to put them into the best solution for them. And we would argue that we need to have a system that is fair but also accessible, and the 10-year rule is stopping that from happening.
Okay, thank you. That's very clear. Thank you. And my final question is simply, is there anything else in terms of the bankrupt reform in this bill you would like to comment on, or is there anything else you think should be put into this bill that's not currently there?
That's a good question. there's the legislation that's been brought into place and into the bankruptcy and diligence bill makes sense in the sense of it needs primary legislation changes. Most of the changes, like for example the protected trustee protocol, can be done through secondary legislation. So a lot of what we called for is already represented in the bill, and the only thing that, you know, one of the things that we would definitely push for is this MAP 10-year rule. I think in terms of what needs to be in the bill, I think one of the things, as I pointed out, is the mental health moratorium. Either in the bill or in the regulations, we need to be building in the tools that already exist. So the debt and mental health evidence form is a form that is used routinely by money advisors and could be used as a trigger for the mental health moratorium. The problem is a lot of that comes with fees and charges if you go to a GP. So by bringing it into the mental health moratorium, we can widen that out and we can make it more accessible for other mental health professionals to complete the debt mental health evidence form for free, which means that it then becomes accessible. And the beauty of the debt mental health evidence form, as I said, it goes beyond just triggering a moratorium. It can lead to credit or forbearance, such as debt write-off. It's such an important form, but it needs to be built in to this process and used more widely than it is currently.
Thank you.
And do you think that would be necessary to put that in the legislation, or would that just be part of the, when we're putting together the guidance on what the...
I would probably say it would just be part of the regulations and guidance, but I think it's definitely something that needs to be...
But you'd look for clarity from the Minister that is the approach that will be adopted.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask a couple of questions on diligence reform, and again, I think Sarah-Jane, I think you're front and centre there, but Becca, if there's anything that you would like to add, then don't hesitate to come in. First question is about calls to reform diligence against earnings, for example, to increase the amount which is protected from creditors, or to build in consideration of family size when calculating deductions, and I can see issues around that particular one. Is this something that has an impact on your clients? Do you support the reform?
Yes. The diligence against earnings is, I think, in line of the protected minimum balance that was brought in regards to bank arrestments was sorely needed because it wasn't enough. And it could be argued that £1,000 protected minimum balance is still not enough, especially in light of the current cost of living crisis. But diligence against earnings is certainly something that is needs to be considered, and especially in regards to household composition. So when you have a client who has an earnings arrestment and a portion of their earnings is taken, regardless of whether they are a single person at home or whether they have a family of five, and that can be a real struggle in terms of affording to pay your bills, and could actually end up leading to more debt than it does support. The thing about earnings arrestments is often, as a money advisor, I've found it acts as a trigger for them to then seek money advice, but only when it goes wrong. So an earnings arrestment, for example, if somebody's earnings arrestment and they're able to, I'll say, manage on their bills, cope. It's a, you know, they're robbing Peter to pay Paul to steal the report's title. When that then tips over because they're finding that they're missing their rent, for example, or they're missing payments on their council tax, or they're not being able to afford to put fuel in the car, and then debt start to build up, they'll then come to seek money advice, and we can look at things like the debt arrangement scheme that can then look at a more affordable repayment plan rather than just taking a full deduction from earnings. And the current diligence scheme doesn't really take account of somebody's situation and personal individual it's just a blanket. If you earn over this amount, we take that amount. If you earn over that amount, we take that amount. Now that works in practice, and it's good. It helps employers. It means that employers are able to put those through. But it does mean that somebody could end up in a far worse debt situation. How we would then build in a situation where they can look at some of these individual household components, and there are ways in which we've done it in the past. The arrangement schemes variation process, for example, does work. And I think Alan McIntosh's proposals, it's certainly something that needs to be considered, especially if we are able to show through debt advisor that a variation on an earnings arrestment isn't going to stop the debt being repaid. It just means it gives them a little bit longer to repay that debt.
You mentioned DAS there as being perhaps an appropriate alternative. Obviously, there's a little bit of controversy about DAS and the fact that a lot of people go into that particular arrangement without adequate financial advice in doing that.
I'm not aware of that. Again, usually
it was something that came up in the previous committee.
Oh, right, okay.
And a report that came out from committee at that point.
Right, okay. In the sense of, I mean, a debt arrangement scheme is applied for on behalf by a money advisor, and I would hope that the rigorous assessment of someone's financial situation is done so that you're able to put someone into a debt arrangement scheme and it's right for them. Having said that, I think there has been since certain changes to, for example, the payment distributors no longer being in the traffic system list and opening that up to other organisations to be a payment distributor can open that up to potentially someone putting someone into a debt arrangement scheme when it's not suitable, similar to what happens with protected trustees. You might put them into a protected trustee and they're actually not suitable for it. I can understand that there is probably some controversy around that, but that is not necessarily around the debt arrangement scheme itself. I'd probably say it's around the fact that certain changes were made to who could be a payment distributor and the expectation on that needs a little bit probably more monitoring done and making sure that it's all about making sure that the person who's seeking debt advice are getting the right solution for them at the right time. But one of the things that needs to come under, and it is coming under hopefully stage three review, I have known clients having to go into a debt arrangement scheme even though bankruptcy is probably a better solution for them because they have a family home to protect. And the debt arrangement scheme allows them to protect their family home. And if they go into a DAS or even go into bankruptcy or protected trustee, they could end up losing that house. And they could end up becoming homeless because that is an asset that needs to be realised for the purposes of the creditors. So there are situations, I do believe, at this moment in time, because the family home is not protected under other forms of diligence, other forms of debt solutions such as bankruptcy, they're then having to go down a solution such as the debt arrangement scheme in order to protect their family home. And that's why the staged re-review is so important, because we do need to make sure that our debt solutions work in harmony with each other almost, and making sure that we are giving a tray of options to people as much as possible, and making sure that it fits as many people as that we can. There are certainly gaps in the debt solution landscape at this moment. The debt solutions that we have don't necessarily fit everybody that are seeking debt support. And there's certainly something that stage three needs to be reviewing and considering.
Coming back to the diligence against earnings, I think we've already touched on the slightly more complex way of handling family sizes and, you know, the issues around that. If it stays, for example, at a fixed amount, how would you peg that? How could that be fairly pegged? Should it be attached to CPI? You know, is there a way to make it fairer?
I think certainly, yes, there is certainly a way to make it fairer and make it more grounded in reality, in the sense of the fact that, you know, before certain changes to the bank arrestments, protected minimum balance, you know, the amount that was protected wasn't reflective of actual people's living standards and living costs that they're having to see today. So I think, yes, we need to make sure that any sort of diligence against earnings or diligence against anything is grounded more in reality and reflects what people's costs actually are. Because if you are taking a chunk of somebody's wages and leaving them in a situation where they're going to then be in financial hardship and not be able to pay their priority bills and commitments, then all you're doing is worsening their situation. You might be repaying a debt, but you're putting them into further debt and a further stress. That being said, earnings arrestments are obviously a tool that creditors need to have in order to recover debt. And so, as I've said before, it can often be a trigger for that person to then go and seek debt advice and look at their options. And what we would always encourage anybody, and hopefully, is that the sooner they seek debt advice, the better. But we do know that people do bury their heads in their sand. They do try and rob Peter to pay Paul, and they try and deal with the situation until it gets to that breaking point that they can no longer deal with it. And earnings arrestments and other forms of diligence are usually that trigger point.
Just to move on, the Scottish Government plans to lay regulations to introduce information disclosure orders and to add inhibition to the options available for enforcement after summary warrant. Do you have any views on the likely impact of these proposals?
From a money advisor's standpoint, it's probably, and from Sets of Advice Scotland, the reason why they're delaying it is we would probably welcome, because it means that they're taking consideration and they're not going down a route. Those forms of information disclosure orders, and those are for the benefits of creditors. I can argue both sides on why it's necessary, but sometimes we do feel that a cautionary approach is wiser, because we don't want to create unintended consequences. And information disclosure orders obviously would allow creditors to be able to assess what assets somebody has in order to then take further action and diligence against them. But is that information disclosure order then going to be followed up with encouraging that person to get debt advice and opening up those discussions, or is it a fishing expedition? So there's ways in which you can look at it. Now, the majority of clients that we see, as I've said before, are clients with negative disposable incomes and no assets. So the likelihood of this impacting on them is probably nil. But having said that, you know, there are people out there that it could impact on. So I think taking a delay is probably a way to make sure that they are balancing the books in the sense of it's fair for both those in debt and creditors.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but isn't the information disclosure orders, aren't they applicable to the private sector only and not the public sector?
As far as I'm aware, yes, but I think we still see somebody as, you know, private sector could be somebody as a sole trader or a partnership, you know, small business, which we you can end up supporting. So it's that's what we were trying to say. Like in our world, it probably doesn't necessarily have a massive impact because the clients that we see are not necessarily going to come under that. So it's very hard. But I can understand why they're probably trying to make sure that they are being fair for creditors and the people that they're trying to seek the money from.
Let me just wind up with one last question, probably as difficult as my colleague Myrtle Fraser gave you. Do you have any comments on the diligence reforms in the bill? And can you suggest any potential additions to the bill in this area?
And for in terms of the diligence, I don't have any further comments, mainly because it is areas in which are out with our client scope. And are in to the realms of, as you were saying, business in the private sector. So we don't feel that we would be an authority in order to speak to that. In terms of anything that needs to be brought into discussion, we would definitely, as we've said, suggested considering diligence against earnings and making sure that it is fair in terms of, and one of the things that we would suggest around bank arrestments, for example, that system as well needs to be considered because bank arrestments are actually the form of diligence that is mostly used other than earnings arrestments. And the bank arrestments are tend to be used against those with the lowest incomes or on benefits only. And we are finding as money advisors that clients' accounts are being frozen because a bank arrestment has been made against them and they are benefits only, but because their benefit goes into their bank account and it loses that protective status, that then their benefits are then taken through a bank arrestment. And a money advisor then has to spend weeks, months arguing back and forth between the creditor and the bank, which also trying to support their client who has now got no income because of a bank arrestment that has been unnecessarily and unfairly processed against them.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much to the two witnesses this morning. Your evidence is really helpful for our consideration of the bill. I will now briefly suspend the meeting while we change over witnesses. Good morning, everybody. Our next item of business is an evidence session on the report by the Fraser of Allender Institute on the economic contribution of the pharmaceutical sector in Scotland. So I welcome Adam McGeoch, Economist Fellow of Fraser of Allender Institute, who's joined by George Davidson, Chair of the Access and Value Group, ABI Scotland, and Sir Michael Ferguson, Regis Professor of Life Sciences, University of Dundee. And I understand that Adam is going to give us a short presentation before we move to questions.
Yes, thank you, Convener, and thank you to the committee for having us along today to discuss our fourth report for ABPI Scotland. And this is looking at the economic contribution of the pharmaceutical sector to Scotland's economy. So our latest report looks at a traditional economic impact assessment in terms of the sector's support for GV and jobs. But given the Scottish Government's National Strategy for Economic Transformation that was published last year, we wanted to widen this impact assessment to include how the sector contributes to things like tackling inequalities and improving the productive capacity of the Scottish economy. So our analysis includes the pharmaceutical sector as defined by ONS, so this narrow definition of manufacturing of pharmaceuticals, but it also includes a wider sector definition, as when we engage with ABPI, we realise that the pharmaceutical sector encompasses more than just pharmaceutical manufacturing, but also things like pharmaceutical research and development, medical sales and so on. And given its importance to Scottish Government economic strategy, we felt it was important to include life sciences in our modelling and analysis. So as I mentioned, we reflected on NSET, but also the delivery plans within NSET that was published last October and the underlying economic indicators under each programme of action. So, for example, in entrepreneurial people and culture, one of the key indicators is business survival rates. So what we did is we looked at our pharmaceutical sectors and compared that to the Scottish average. And, for example, we found that the life sciences has a business survival rate of 3 years of 67%, and this exceeds the Scottish average, but also the Scottish growth sector average. So we did this for a number of indicators under each programme of action to track progress against NSET to see how the pharmaceutical sectors contribute to Scotland's 10-year economic strategy. Overall, we found that the sector contributes significantly to the Scottish economy. For example, the wider pharmaceutical sector contributes £1.7 billion in gross value added to the Scottish economy and supports over 15,000 Scottish jobs.
Thank you very much. We'll move to questions. If people can keep their answers and questions concise, that would be helpful. Can I maybe start? You refer to NSET, which is the 10-year economic strategy that the government have in place. Can we come to George, first of all? As an organisation, do you see the impact of NSET? Has there been any changes since? I know we're thinking in year two. Have there been any changes? And in what ways do you engage with the Scottish Government?
Thank you, Convener. I'm George Davidson here, representing the pharmaceutical industry as part of ABPI Scotland. I think in general, to answer your question, the Fraser of Allender report has been very positive, and we do it to hopefully highlight the sector. But I think also, if we look at it, we're a bit of a tipping point at the moment in terms of where we are as an industry. If we really want life sciences to move on to that next level, it's been quite well publicised that there's been a decline in clinical trials, which kind of impacts onward investment by industry. There's a need, obviously, for regulatory to kind of speed up approval of new medicines. It's difficult because there's new treatments, there's different requirements. And how do we deploy those innovative medicines quickly? So I think running alongside that, of course, as well, we're in negotiation period as a pharmaceutical industry about the new voluntary pricing and access scheme, which is at quite a critical stage. We've capped the medicines bill at 2% to allow medicines to be used in an innovative manner. But recently, the repayment rates got up to like 26.5%, which isn't really sustainable. So I can't see how that's going to map out, but basically, there's lots of discussions on at the moment about how we can basically drive, you know, the right environment for investment. So I think at the moment, you're probably seeing as well some companies making decisions to invest out with Scotland stroke the UK. So I think, as I say, I would just describe it as being at a tipping point at the moment.
Mm-hmm. And do you find, as I asked about the kind of engagement with the Scottish Government, is there a forum that you're able to speak to the government about?
Yes, I think we're very... content, if you like, want a better word. We have a life sciences cross-party group which meets regularly, and I think as an ABPI industry, we've had good support. We've been campaigning for a number of areas, primarily data, to try and get the Scottish data infrastructure set up that will actually attract that foundation for inward investment. And I would say we have very good support. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Because what would you say are the main... I mean, you've outlined some around clinical trials and pricing, but are there barriers, particularly in Scotland, for growth for the sector? Because you've indicated that it's a sector that has potential for greater growth in Scotland, so why are...
They are without doubt the main barriers. If you take clinical trials and you think about it, it gets companies to invest, but it also helps get patients access to medicines and innovation that they almost wouldn't have. There's also a piece around how do you look at the whole health inequalities piece, and can that be better, mapped through if you've got better clinical trials infrastructure? I think, going back to your question on the support, we have engaged very well with the Chief Scientist Officer, and Dame Anna Domenichik's been a fantastic supporter and talks at length about the need for a triple helix approach, as she puts it, which is very much about having industry as part of that solution. So I don't see the problems being any unique in Scotland versus the rest of the UK.
And I'll bring in Sir Michael Ferguson. So in 2015, the Scottish Government Economic Strategy, so that's now 8 years ago, identified life sciences as a growth sector. Do you think since 2015 we've seen the growth that we would hope to have seen? Obviously, we've had a pandemic, which has an impact on everything. And what do you think the barriers are to increasing the role of pharmaceuticals in Scotland?
Thank you very much, Convener. So, George is speaking on behalf of the existing industries in life sciences and pharmaceuticals. My concern is really with future companies, creating new companies to get economic growth. And in that context, I think Scotland could do so much more to help itself. We have a university sector, which is very, very strong in life sciences. So, Scotland wins about 14% of the UK R&D budget, if you like, in their universities competitively. And yet we produce only 6% of UK spin-outs in life sciences. So there's a big divide there. And I think there's a number of things which make the landscape of Scotland not fertile enough to create those spin-out companies in the first place, and then, even more tragically, keep them when we do. My own experience at the University of Dundee is, Exscientia was the biggest IPO, biotechnology IPO in Europe ever. Not this year, last year, but ever. $510 million on the NASDAQ. And it's in Oxford, mostly. There's a little bit left in Dundee, but it was a University of Dundee spin-out. And Amphista Therapeutics, another one, did one of the largest Series B rounds in biotechnology in 2021. It's now 100% in Cambridge. I call this levelling down. So we are able to create highly invested spin-out companies, and yet we lose them from Scotland because we don't have the infrastructure to keep them here. So there's two problems. One is that we don't create enough spin-out companies at scale because we don't attract enough venture capital. And that's partly not our fault. It's partly because the venture capital community tends to fish in the golden triangle of Oxford, Cambridge, and London. What it really means is we have to jump through a few more hoops to get their attention, so we should just do that. But we need some public sector investment to help us jump through those hoops and create more high-growth companies. And then we need to be properly invested with serious venture capital money, not with angel investment only, because that tends to lead to small zombie companies, frankly. We need to get major investment in, and then we need to make sure that investment doesn't just bounce off Scotland and go someplace else. So if we can fix those two things, I believe we can create a huge amount of economic growth for Scotland.
Now, you've both raised areas where other members will ask questions, but before we move to that, can I just maybe ask Adam a question about the Fraser Valander report? On page 25, you talk about the gender pay gap within the sector, I think in Scotland it's a bigger gap than it is across the UK, is that right? So 22% women earn 22% less than men work in the sector, compared to just 6% less at the UK level, though we have a narrower pay gap across all sectors. You suggest it depends where women tend to be focused within the pharmaceutical sector, and it's more in supply chain than... Could you maybe just talk us through why there is such a gap in Scotland?
Yes, thank you, Convener. So when we were looking at the pay data for pharmaceuticals, it's quite difficult to get a picture of Scotland when you're looking at industry, and then at a regional level to get data that's available. So we had to look at 2021 because the data was suppressed for 2022. But when we did look, yes, we found that the gender pay gap was 22% in the manufacturing of pharmaceuticals in Scotland. If we compare that to the UK manufacturing of pharmaceuticals, it's 6%. And if we compare it to just an industry average around Scotland of 12%, there's clearly work that needs to be done. In terms of the supply chain impacts, we looked at the economic impact of the pharmaceutical sector and then looked at the industries in which it trades with, and to determine the gender split of that impact that it has. And we did find that, while there's not as much employment directly supported within pharmaceuticals, it tends to be in the industries that pharma trades with, such as in retail and in sales and medical liaison and these types of industries, so not directly supported.
Mm-hmm. So, George, I don't know if you could say something from ABPI about what needs to be done to tackle the gender pay gap, if it's recognised as being an issue that does need to be addressed, and what has been done to address it.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think, you know, the report clearly highlights and is an issue that needs to be addressed. From an ABPI point of view, they have done a survey of members, an Accenture report, which basically... indicated that I think it was 62 or 68% of members had this as a priority. If I speak, you know, from there's a I think in within the report, Roche Pharmaceuticals highlighted what they're doing. So to Adam's point, it's difficult when you get down to the subsets. I can talk about large pharma. So for example, the organisation I work for, we have got a minus 1.36% in terms of the mean gender pay gap. But you know, hands up, it's something that ABPI are going to have to keep pushing with members to say address this, because it's not acceptable.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we'll move on to some of the areas that have been highlighted already, and I'm actually going to bring in Brian Whittle first, because he's going to ask a question around clinical trials.
Yes,
and that's been raised by George.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I actually have got a kind of interesting sort of clinical trials and how those are conducted. And I think especially for you know, treatments of maybe rare conditions that require, you know, clinical trials to be drawn from beyond our borders. In fact, it's to, surely to the benefit of any new drug that we draw from as wide a diverse population as we possibly can. How are we aligned to be able to deal with the rest of the world, for example, to pull clinical trials together that sort of for the efficacy of any new medicines?
Happily start off that, Mr. Whittle, thank you for the question. So I think that's the real problem, if you like. So since 2017, we've seen a kind of, you know, 44% decline in patients entering clinical trials, 41% drop in terms of the number of clinical trials being cited across the UK. And you're right to point out, you know, Scotland on its own, it's got some fantastic potential with its population size, with the CHI number, but for organisations and global organisations that want to cite trials, you have to do it across, you know, the more specialised medicines. The populations are very small, so therefore you need to broaden it out. But there was a review done by Lord O'Shaughnessy, which looked at the clinical trials, of which Dame Anna Domenichik is very much all over. And, you know, there's some good recommendations come out of that to try and reverse what's happening. So I think from a Scottish point of view, one of the areas I mentioned that we're pushing on is data. What you want to be able to do is have the data infrastructure there so that if companies want to come and do their clinical trials, the databases, etc., are there. But we need to, as I say, just create that. So, you know, they've got an aim to quadruple the number of people who take part in clinical trials by 2027. There's quite a lot of funding going into it. And I know from talking to Dame Anna, she's absolutely clear about working with industry to make sure Scotland plays its part within that.
Follow on from that, do
do we not have a sort of global network, a data network, where which we can pull on and tap into to pull potential people for clinical trials?
I think there'll be networks. How joined up it is, doesn't seem to be as cohesive as it could be. Even if you look in Scotland, it's not as cohesive as it could be in terms of how companies can access that data. That's one of the things they're looking at the moment.
Thank you. I don't know if there may, before I move on to my next question, anybody else wants to jump in there?
Just to pick up on what George was saying just there, something we touched on in the report was that in the Trade and Nation report, the Scottish Government, clinical trials was highlighted as a subsector of pharmaceuticals that has potential to really drive export growth within the sector. Something that we picked up on the report is addressing some of the issues around clinical trial wait times could support the sector and its export performance, to be honest, it already performs well in, but to for it to perform better in terms of international export.
I think sorry, go on, Sir Michael.
Just one point. I mean, stratification is really the name of the game in clinical trials going forward. You mentioned, for sort of rare diseases and so on. The point is to give the right medicines to the right people, and therefore using genetic information is becoming more and more important in clinical trials, that you test the medicine for the people who are likely to benefit from it and not likely to be poisoned by it. And this is really important. And so the whole landscape of clinical trials is changing enormously. And, of course, you need to be testing medicines in the appropriate population. So, for example, my institution has an anti-malarial compound, single-dose cure, that's in clinical trials in sub-Saharan Africa, because there's no point testing it in Scotland, because we don't have malaria. So it's a question of the clinical trials being done with the right populations. But Scotland has such a fantastic opportunity to do clinical trials, especially in chronic diseases, where we unfortunately score rather well. So we have an incredibly appropriate population for running clinical trials in medicines for morbidities. And we have a very well joined up informatics system, which is the envy of England, by the way. But we could do so much more. It's really this kind of slight frustration that we have many of the tools that we need to be a real go-to place for clinical trials, and yet we are not managing to achieve that. Part of it is the NHS is reeling from the COVID crisis and finds it difficult to find the time to concentrate on bringing in those clinical trials. Thank you.
That's been quite a dramatic drop.
Yeah.
It is, it's 41% since 2017-18. Mm-hmm. Is it the pandemic? We've had Brexit. We've got a war in Ukraine. Is it these factors, or is it something more structural? You've said about capacity with NHS. It's something more mundane, is that? Or?
Well, I'm wondering if all of those factors, but the bit is, it's what Adam was saying, it's about the... and Dame Anna speaks well to this, just around the commercial clinical trials versus other types of research that's going on. So I think that's the bit that's drifted off. And, if you look at Spain and Australia, Spain have got a fantastic infrastructure and network for clinical trials. They really have taken off with what they're doing. So I just think we need to hit the reset button a little bit on this one and make sure, because it has lots of spin-off effects, as we mentioned, around the whole health inequalities. And indeed, to help the NHS recover, I think there's research within the paper that talks about, when you have centres that are doing clinical research, actually there's knock-on effects to sort of staff morale, et cetera, et cetera. So I think, yeah.
OK, do you have any other questions, Mr. Whittle, before me?
Yeah. I've got to say, it sounds to me like there's an opportunity out there for an entrepreneur to around the gathering of data. Anyway, I wanted a question to some of my colleagues who raised around the spin-off companies out of new businesses, that sort of SME-type growth.
I think Gordon MacDonald's intend to come in on that area of question.
I do apologise.
Yeah, is that fine? So if I move over, that's if we've dealt with clinical trials, Gordon MacDonald.
OK, thanks very much, convener. Good morning, panel. We've already touched upon spin-offs, and I want to just try and understand that position a bit better. So, Adam, as author of the report, maybe come to you first. You've said in the report that scale-up is a barrier to success and Scotland loses spin-outs and talents to England. But in the same report, you're saying supported by a knowledge exchange from world-renowned universities and extensive government support, have made Scotland one of the largest life science clusters in Europe, made up of over 770 enterprises. You then go on to say the number of businesses manufacturing pharmaceuticals has increased by 40% since 2010, and had a look back at your 2017 report, and you had a very helpful table of employment from 2009. And in 2009, total Scottish pharmaceutical employment was 2,200, and it currently for the wider pharmaceutical sector is 5,900. So I'm trying to understand, where's this difficulty with spin-offs that's been referred to earlier on?
For that question. So in terms of the clusters mentioned, that we're reflecting on some analysis done by Scottish Development International. So that's where that came from. And on the life science spin-outs, it's more that the number of spin-outs is strong, and Scotland per head does have some of the best universities in the world, and we always perform well on higher education measures compared to the rest of the UK and the UK and internationally. It's more less about the number, but more about the scaling up. So making sure that we have the infrastructure for when those businesses want to get bigger, and making sure, as Sir Mike Ferguson noted in the case study, having the lab space and the infrastructure for these life sciences spin-outs to scale up in Scotland. Otherwise, they can be lost to the Golden Triangle, it's called, of Oxford and Cambridge.
On your report, you've got a chart 3 which says top universities for life science spin-outs. What is that chart trying to tell us? What's it saying? I think the Scottish universities are in red. Edinburgh University, 18 spin-offs, 2 were exiled. Is that probably down to the Golden Triangle you were talking about?
Yeah. When it comes, and maybe someone will want to come in here, with the life science spin-outs, the point here was that there is the talent and the knowledge here in Scotland. It's just that it is when it comes to scaling up, and best place to talk more about that would probably be Mike, in terms of the challenges in the life sciences sector.
So just before you come in, Mike, I'm trying to understand this table a wee bit better, because if I read across the various universities that are listed, and I accept it's only a proportion of the universities, because obviously Dundee University isn't mentioned on that table. But if you look at it, there were 51 spin-offs, of which 4 were exited in Scotland, according to your table. And in the UK, there was 248 spin-offs, which would suggest the spin-offs in Scotland are higher on a population basis. And there was 48 that exited south of the border, which again is a higher proportion of the total number that you've presented. So, you know, again, I'm trying to understand, is it the fact that we're creating them but we're not retaining them, but your figures don't highlight that we're not retaining them?
Yeah, what we found is that we create them, but yes, we don't retain. And just touching on the data here, and something me and Mike have spoke about, is that other data sources depend on the underlying indicators of the different types of spin-outs. And Dundee and many rankings come out on top when it comes to spin-outs, which isn't reflected here. In terms of the exited companies, that's those that are bought over and leave that market. So the point here is that we do have that capability in our Scottish universities, but it's just about the scaling up. I can't speak on what is happening to other universities in the rest of the UK, because we did not look at that in the report. We were just focused on the Scottish universities.
I've just lifted the numbers off your graph, that's all. Michael, I was wanting to ask you, you've got a case study and you mentioned the two companies, Amphista Therapeutics and Exentia, if I've pronounced them correctly. One, Amphista started in 2017 and Exentia started in 2012, if I've got that right.
That's correct.
Looking at their latest accounts would suggest that Amphista made a substantial loss in 2020. And in 2021, has total employees of 20 and has a net worth of -£5 million.
Well,
It has 100 employees, actually.
I lifted it off their accounts that were on Companies House. That was all the information I had.
I mean, it'd be interesting about it. Yeah, OK. So the point is that it's in the Series B investment phase at the moment. So It's an R&D-based company, platform company. And I'm a bit surprised by those numbers. I don't know where they came from. Because, for example, it's got £2.3 billion worth of business on its books from BMS, Bristol Myers Squibb and Merck KGaA. And it's passed the first milestones in both of those big contracts. So it's trading very, very well at the moment. But you know, these numbers also lag considerably the current realities.
Yeah.
So that's what I would say about Amphista. I think it's everybody's looking at it as being very successful and expects at some point that it will IPO, will exit through an intellectual property offering and probably do extremely well, as Exscientia did, for example, when it IPO'd in 2021.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the figures I lifted were from Companies House, and it was the latest published accounts on Companies House. So I realise there is a lag between
them.
But it would suggest that, similar to Exscientia, that it's been recent that the improvement in its financial position is, because back in 2020, if, again, this is from Companies House, Exscientia only had 65 employees, if I'm reading it correctly. Yeah. So it's only in 2021, 22 that we've seen this substantial
growth,
which we didn't have when they were created back in 2012.
Yeah. So, I mean, the natural history of biotechnology, and in fact, all technology companies, is they get invested in through seed investment, Series A, Series B, and during that time they're making a loss because they're growing their company base and they're creating their products, if you like, and then when they get to a successful position, that's when they'll go to the market to exit and get a huge IPO, and that's when they go into mega growth phase.
Right.
So Exscientia is now over 500 employees, 50 still in Dundee, I'm happy to say, but 450 elsewhere.
Okay.
Yeah.
So moving on to the other questions I'm going to ask, you had in your case study, and you touched upon this earlier, that there is a need for a public-private fund that backs life sciences and innovation ideas. Can you say a wee bit more about that?
Yeah, I'd be very keen on this. I mean, I've probably spoken to something like 30 venture capital companies in the last 2.5 years, and it's always the same conversation, which is you put in front of them your bright young ideas that for innovation and spin-out opportunities, and they will pick and choose. Different VCs will like different things, but they nearly all come back with the same thing. We really like this opportunity, but just come back when you've done A, B, and C. And that might be a bit of market research, but more often than not, it's sort of like killer experiments, proof of concept experiments. And the private sector expects the public sector to pick up that bill, and vice versa. And nobody's picking up that bill. And usually for the sake of £250,000 or something, an innovation opportunity that's probably cost the charitable and public purse £20 to £30 million of research to get to this innovation position for the sake of £250,000, you can't get it to an investable asset. So there's a gap between innovation and investable asset. Now, if you're in the Golden Triangle, the VCs will kind of say, oh, well, we'll give you some money anyway. We don't get that luxury in Scotland. We need to close that little gap. And that's why I talk about this 1% fund. We, you know, Scottish universities win about 500 million, a little bit more now, of competitively won research funds in bioscience and medicine every year. And yet we're producing half the productivity of our colleagues in the Golden Triangle in terms of spin-outs and job creation and wealth creation. And I think we can close that gap by enabling Scotland's universities to have that fund to help them get their innovation through to an investable asset. Basically, you have to tee up the opportunities a little bit higher in Scotland than you do elsewhere. So either we can complain about that or we can just do it. And I think we should just do it. And that way we will bring a huge amount of inward investment into Scotland. And if we have the right infrastructure, we'll make it stick in Scotland. Have high quality jobs for our graduates, postgraduates, but very importantly for our school leavers. Biotechnologies, the workforce in the R&D component of biotechnology is about 50% technicians, right? So folk who can leave school, get an HNC qualification and move into that industry. These are the kind of jobs that we need for our young people in Scotland, in my opinion.
Just my final point to yourself before I come to George. How do we ensure that manufacturing jobs, once we get out of the research and development phase, are retained in Scotland? I'm aware from my son used to work in life sciences until fairly recently, and it was an American investor that was involved in their company, but the manufacturing, despite all the R&D being done in Scotland, the manufacturing plant of that American investor was in Europe.
Yeah, this is a really difficult... there is no magic answer to that. If we can anchor companies in the R&D phase in Scotland, then there's a chance of the manufacturing staying in Scotland. If we don't anchor the R&D in Scotland, there's no chance of the manufacturing in Scotland. That's all I can say. But it is a probabilities game, and the complexities of investment and investment decisions, commercial decisions by investors, is something you can try to sway. In Dundee, we have a company which is in R&D mode at the moment, and by remonstrating with the chair of its board, I've managed to keep it in Dundee a little bit longer. How long we can manage that for, I don't know. But, you know, we can all just do what we can to make Scotland an attractive and fertile ground for companies to stay. Even if we can only keep them through the R&D phase and keep the R&D arm, that's still a net benefit to GVA for Scotland, I mean, a substantial one. If we can also get them to put the manufacturing here, if it's that kind of business, that would be a massive bonus. That's a complex one. George, you might want to comment.
No, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, I work for an organisation that's got two manufacturing sites in Scotland, and you know, we've gone through spells where it was kind of a bit rocky. One was going to shut, and we've thankfully kept it open. And actually, now out of the recession, things are looking good. Touch wood. But I would totally agree with what you're saying, Mike, that, you know, if the bit that ABPI are focused on is, can we get the investment at the R&D stage, the clinical trials in? Because then once you have a company bought in, it's easier for them to then say what they want to do. And, you know, the Medicines Manufacturing Innovation Centre at Renfrew should be held up as a beacon of what can be achieved. You know, we should really try and get funding in from companies to really, really accelerate that as much as we can.
Has Brexit made that harder?
Brexit.
Given that there's a market of 550 million people there, and it's harder for us to actually trade with Europe because of what's happened over recent years?
I don't think you can point it just at one thing, to be honest with
no,
you.
No, but it's obviously a number of factors.
There are challenges, of course, yeah. There are challenges, but, you know, there are equally challenges. I said before, you know, if you really think about research now, you're not just going to have it all cited just in Scotland. You've got to think broader, so... Yeah, I just think we need to... Everyone knows the solution. Everyone can talk about it and know what the solutions are. We've just got to get on and do them. I think, you know, that's the key thing, really.
So I've got a couple of questions for you, George. One is, we talked about the golden triangle of Oxford, Cambridge and London.
Yep.
Yeah, Scotland is the highest number of education students enrolled in STEM subjects, and Scottish population has a higher proportion of people who have got higher education or degree to the degree status. So what's the difficulty in retaining jobs here when we've got a highly educated population and we've got a lot of students in STEM subjects?
Yeah, no, I agree. I think the challenge is probably just set up, and people sometimes do what they've always done. In all honesty, I think, you know, within my own organisation, I'm always trying to encourage people to come up to Scotland and see what the art of the possible is, because, you know, I think... As we mentioned at the start, we get very good support. It's a great infrastructure. There is talk of the triple helix, and I think, you know, through ABPI, we're always trying to put on innovative type workshops to get the people that make these investments to say, come to Scotland, see what's possible. I think, you know, like it or not, that golden triangle, it's a tipping point. Mike and I were talking about it. You know, the Tay Cities deal for Dundee is a good thing, because that will hopefully, you know, it gives a bit more infrastructure. And I think we will reach a point where we've got all the stats. It's just how do you get people to kind of come and see for themselves what's possible.
Yeah. And my final question, and then I'll pass back to the convener. I noticed that pharmaceutical exports were up, I think it was 9%, but exports to the rest of the UK was down from 155 million to 50 million. Was there a reason for that?
It's funny, I was just chatting to Adam because I didn't know the reason myself and I saw it, just that kind of the difference, the UK versus international. We were saying potentially, you know, there could be a number of things. I was thinking from our own organisational point of view, we, if you go back to that time period, we were under quite a lot of pressure from different suppliers and were sourcing some chemicals from, you know, India and China, which has now reverted back, thankfully. So our site, you know, in Irvine, we can't manufacture enough at the moment, which is fantastic. So we were saying it'll be interesting to see the next batch of figures that comes through with the revenue going up, and hopefully that will reverse itself. But yeah, I don't know the exact reason to be straight about it.
Right. Yeah.
And the magic ingredient is serious investment, venture capital investment, both national and international. You know, these companies need to have seed funding of 2 to 5 million, Series A funding of 5 to 15 million, and Series B funding of 15 to 60 million. And if you're not in that area, you're not going to have a high growth company. Right. And so we have very bright people with great ideas, but they're underinvested in.
Okay.
Yeah.
So just, I was going to pass back, but I've just thought of another question. There was a report from Deloitte that came out in January that said that the average expected return on investment from research and development had fell from 6.8% to 1.2% in 2022. So given that that's the lowest level of return on investment on record, is that making it more difficult to attract this funding that you're talking about?
Yeah, so yes, of course. At the moment, everybody says, oh, you know, it's really difficult raising funding for spin-outs. Actually, if you look at the graphs, you see what happened was in 2021, there was a massive spike of investment. During the pandemic, people had all of this money. Equities were overvalued, so they put it into venture. And now it's come back down, but it's still on an upward trajectory. Right. It's just a spike on top of an upward trajectory. So there is still money, venture capital money around. The returns just at the moment are not looking so clever because of the overinvestment spike has actually diluted the returns. So I think it's an adjustment in the economics that we're seeing at the moment. Okay. That's my view.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Adam, did you want to respond to the question about exports to the UK? Did you have...
No, just a quick follow-up from what George was saying. Our assumption was that perhaps there was a restructuring, so perhaps something that was produced in Scotland was then produced in the rest of the UK that year, and that's something me and George were talking about. And that the latest data we have is for 2019, because export statistics Scotland were delayed in recent years, but we should get figures for 2020 and 2021 in November of this year, which will allow us to dig a bit deeper to understand, is this a long-term trend or is this just a one-off?
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Murdo Fraser to be followed by Ash Regan.
Thank you, Convener. I've just got a couple of issues just to follow up on the line of questioning from Gordon MacDonald. First of all, to yourself, Adam, just so I can get this clear in my head, because you say in your report that Scotland lags behind other parts of the UK in generating life science spin-outs. And yet the figure that Gordon MacDonald alluded to suggested in numbers that we perform well. So is that because the overall level of investment is lower?
So with engagement with Sir Mike, yes, we found that the overall level of investment was lower and it was a challenge around scale-up. What we covered in the report was that the numbers of spin-outs are strong, but it's a scale-up.
Yeah, okay, thanks. So just come on to Sir Mike, if I call you Sir Mike.
Yes, please.
Is that right? So you identified two key barriers.
Yeah.
One was infrastructure and the second was access to venture capital. Yeah. So first of all, infrastructure. By infrastructure, you mean, I assume, access to facilities, building space. What do we need to do to fill that gap? What is the role, for example, of agencies like Scottish Enterprise, local authorities? You know, what role do you see the public sector might have in trying to address these issues?
Thank you. Well, in fact, through the city deals, I think actually the situation is getting much better. So, for example, in my city of Dundee, by this time next year, we will have an innovation hub built, which is ideally designed for biotechnology and biopharma spin-out companies. And it's the lack of that to date which has caused us to lose Exscientia and Amphista, but hopefully we'll stop doing that. And we're in discussion with Scottish Enterprise about their level of investment into that building structure as we speak. So I think, and then Aberdeen, for example, has just opened a biohub as well through its cities deal. The Edinburgh Bioquarter is well invested, and so on. So I think we're gradually producing the infrastructures that Scotland needs to retain its spin-outs. Do we have enough infrastructure? Probably not, but it's not as chronic as it was a few years ago. I think that's good. So I think what we then need to do, as I keep on going back to, is make sure that when we have innovation to create spin-outs, that we give it that little boost so that when it goes to the market for its initial venture capital investment, it gets serious investment rather than dribbles, right? Because we get a very large number of spin-out companies, but they're all small companies, one person and their dog companies. And frankly, that doesn't push the needle on the economy.
Okay, so the second part you mentioned was access to venture capital. Yeah. This is a perennial issue. I remember sitting on this predecessor committee 2 decades ago. We were talking about that then. You know, we're still talking about it. What role, if any, do you think something like the Scottish National Investment Bank has here in terms of attracting more venture capital into the sector?
Right, well, I'm not going to say anything too controversial, but it seems to me it seems to me that the Scottish National Investment Bank should absolutely be investing in exactly this. Unfortunately, I don't know, maybe it's too small beer for them in a way. I mean, for instance, a pan-Scottish investment fund, just for life sciences I'm talking about now, to basically fix this innovation, to teeing it up as a highly investable asset, to bring in serious venture capital, we could do that for £5 million a year. Now, that, you know, and I think the returns on that would be enormous, right? I think the at steady state the returns would be well in excess of £250 million of inward VC investment. In terms of GVA, it'd be over £50 million a year, and so on. So the returns would be really extraordinarily good. But don't seem to get any traction with SNIB on this particular. We have spoken to them, but nobody seems to want to step in and fill that gap. And I would prefer it was public-private. What do I mean by that? I think if you set up, if there was a sufficient public sector investment in this area, you would bring in venture capital partners who would want a seat at the table to see the opportunities that are coming through from Scotland. And that's why I think you would end up with a public-private fund. So if the public sector was to put in, say, £5 million a year into this, pretty soon that's going to be a £10 million a year fund, because you might have 4 or 5 major VCs that would be essentially sitting at the table and co-investing at that very early stage.
OK, thank you. Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you. Kevin Stewart, is it linked to...
Convener. I'd be interested to find out more around about the discussions with the Scottish National Investment Bank, and maybe Mike and others can forward us that details. In terms of that joint public-private investment that you're talking about, I wonder if there has been any discussion with any organisation, whether that be SNIB or whether that be Scottish Enterprise, or maybe even with some of the regional economic bodies like Opportunity North East, because you hinted at the work that they were doing, about establishing an evergreen fund whereby investment is made, possibly by public, also by private, and that, you know, eventually gets a return, which then can be recycled, so that we have got that constant recycling, that constant growth of investment. Has there been any discussion around about that? And if so, could you give us an indication of how that discussion has gone?
Yes, thank you. So Scottish Enterprise have been in discussion with myself and colleagues about this for some time now, and they just commissioned ECOS over this summer to do some data collection, and I have a follow-up discussion from the ECOS report with Scottish Enterprise next Monday, so that's all good. And so they've been looking very closely at this idea of a pan-Scottish life sciences innovation to investable asset proof of concept fund, and they're coming to a view on that. But I think they see the opportunity there as well. I do agree with the evergreening. I think if the public sector put in, you know, of the order of £5 million a year for 6 years, I think by the end of that time it could be self-sustaining, and that the public intervention wouldn't be necessary anymore, because, as you say, it could take the fund could take a small amount of the equity of the things that it's investing in, and eventually that will pay back. I mean, one major IPO, like the Exscientia one, which was $510 million, will pay back. 1% of that would pay back the whole fund.
So I think, you know, we can all be a bit negative when we're discussing these issues, but the report itself talks about Scottish enterprise and the role that has played in startups in Scotland since 2016 and 2020, and that's not insubstantial. The investment by Opportunity North East in terms of building that infrastructure is not insubstantial. Do you think that there should be greater cooperation between all of the players here in order to get that right and to open up discussions around about things like my proposal of an evergreen fund, which I think could make the odds here as it has done in other areas?
Absolutely. I think the more joined up we are, the better. I think the article that I wrote says that we need to be more joined up.
So how do we do that then, Mike?
Well, you know, I think Scottish Funding Council, which looks after the university's day-to-day business, and Scottish Enterprise probably need to be talking to each other a bit more often than perhaps they do. And I think also both of those agencies need to be plugged into Scottish National Investment Bank. And we have a good avenue through the cross-party group on life sciences into the Scottish government. And I've always had productive discussions with members of the Scottish Parliament whenever I've asked for them. So I think the connectivity into government is good. I do think that the agencies of government need to be cross-referencing. Now, they have a lot of different things to think about and to worry about. So I don't underestimate the pressures on everybody's time. But in the life sciences industries, I think, you know, Scotland really has a fantastic opportunity to harvest and capitalise on its university sector, which is so strong in the life sciences, and make sure that that works to the benefit of our key stakeholder, which is the taxpayer, the Scottish taxpayer.
Thank you.
We are experiencing some pressure on our time now, so I'll ask members to be concise if possible. I'm Ash Regan, to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thank you. We're always interested in the Scottish Parliament on committees about what's working well elsewhere, even if it's really, you know, a further field. So are there lessons from elsewhere in how we could be better supporting life sciences and the industry?
Well, I'm happy to kick off. I mean, I think that for us, the Achilles heel at the moment, it's larger pharma, but it brings obviously a lot of, you know, investment, is just this deal with the government about medicines. So, you know, if you look at lessons from elsewhere, you've got markets such as Germany, Spain, Ireland, where the kind of rebate rates are between 12 and 8.25%. We're at 26.5. Now, whether we like it or not, that's not sustainable. We've capped the medicines growth at 2%, but I think, you know, industry will vote with their feet if they don't get this one sorted out. So I think, you know, we need to probably look and see. And it wouldn't be so bad, but we're not at the forefront in terms of innovative medicines getting to patients at the end result. So we don't sit well in the rankings. And I mentioned clinical trials. You know, we've dropped to 10th in the world in terms of phase 3 clinical trials. That's not a good position to be in. So I think we need to... Why are Spain, Bethlehem doing clinical trials than we are? It shouldn't be the case. To Mike's point, we've got the best academic centres you could wish for. Mm. You know, we've got a really cohesive network. It's just back to that bit. I think it just... And, you know, Mr. Stewart made the point. I think how do we, through the cross-party group, we try to get people to come together. It's just about collaborating, get the right people in the room to make it happen.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Anyone else want to contribute?
I think that, you know, if you look at south of the border, for example, where, let's take Oxford, they've got Oxford Sciences Enterprises, which is a fund which is a commercial fund that where major investors have sort of put money in to basically commercialise Oxford's scientific outputs. We don't have such a thing in Scotland. UCL Partners is a similar thing in London. Northern Gridstone, of course, is something, a movement in the same general area for getting pre-investment to go then go looking to invest in their university's innovation. We don't have a comparable entity in Scotland.
Okay.
But we probably need one.
Okay.
No, nothing to add to that. Thanks.
And then if I just move on briefly, obviously the COVID-19 pandemic, I think for the industry and for government, things obviously, the way we're working changed, levels of support changed. Is there, I suppose, things that we can learn from that as well that we should be continuing that we maybe don't want to just leave in the past there and we need to take forward?
Yeah, no, I think it's a key point that we should never lose. And it's funny, we're a cross-party group, we were just saying that, you know, how quickly people forget after COVID, there's a lot of bad things with COVID, but there's also a lot of good things came out of it in terms of collaborative working, breaking down barriers, not working in silos. Mm. If you look at how quickly they brought vaccines to the market, I think there's lots of learnings for us to take from that model. And hopefully a lot of the things I talked about, although I don't want to paint a negative picture, it's almost saying this is the art of the possible, this is what we can do if we really just keep that momentum going. And I think Dame Anna is a fantastic supporter from a Scottish perspective about, you know, as I keep saying, she talks about the triple helix, and if anyone who's met her, she's a force to be reckoned with. And I think, you know, it's great for Scotland. She's going down wanting to find out what's happening with the life sciences vision, making sure Scotland's got its place at the table, and I think that's got to be a good thing.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Colin Baker.
Thank you, Convener. I'm going to ask you a fairly obvious question here. You would think that with a unified health service such as the NHS, that there might be an opportunity for the industry in Scotland to collaborate together. And I'm not sure, from what I've read here, the level of collaboration there is, if any, and what would the benefits be of that collaboration?
So pharmaceutical industry is collaborating together?
Collaborating with the NHS.
Yeah. No, I absolutely. And again, I think go back to what I was just saying, that there is quite a lot of that goes on behind the scenes that maybe doesn't get publicised enough. But I think, you know, there's we're just rewriting through ABPI and Scottish Government the Memorandum of Understanding so that, you know, partnership working can take place in a very open public way. So that's always been done. We're working with Professor Alison Strath at the moment just around, I mentioned some of the more innovative medicines. So she's looking at the horizon scanning and how it's not just about the medicine, but it's about having the infrastructure in place and what industry can do to help support that before a medicine comes to market so that you get fast uptake. And I think industry's got a fantastic role to play to help the NHS out of the situation that it's in post-pandemic. So I think,
but I'm not clear on the scale of that. I mean, you would think it would be obvious that this would be a partner you would deal with.
No, I'm with you. But you know, to put it bluntly then, if you look at there's probably still a lot of scepticism between industry and the NHS. I'm not saying which side it's on, but, you know, I think industries are often quite willing to go out and get involved, but it's not often. It takes a while. You think it sounds an easy thing to do, but it's difficult sometimes to get it going. I think the Centre for Sustainable Delivery, I think there's a lot of stuff happening through that now. And I think we're beginning to see a kind of more sort of Scotland-wide, once for Scotland approach, which hopefully will bring industry in to do more of it. But yeah, we probably all need to take our ownership to say, how do we accelerate it?
What are the barriers to getting this collaboration escalated to a better level? I mean, is there recalcitrance on the part of one or other parties?
No, I was maybe putting it across poorly. I think there's been a bit of a hesitancy sometimes about, is it industry? What are they in it for? You know, do they invest then? Do they pull out their money? So there's all of that bit. But, you know, there's lots of great examples and case studies when industry have got involved that make a difference. They just have to accelerate it.
But is it hesitancy on the part of the NHS or on the part of industry?
No, I think if you look at the NHS at the moment, you know, if you're an industry wanting to go and get stuff done, it's kind of difficult as well because they're under the cosh a little bit around, you know, they've got waiting lists, they've got, you know, everything else to deal with, and then there's industry coming along maybe wanting to do some innovation, and people probably want to do it, but where's the headspace to do it? So I think there's a bit of that goes into it?
So if you look at the issue with COVID, which came in over a period of a couple of years or so there, pre-COVID, was there more collaboration than there is post-COVID?
No, I'd say there was less, probably.
Less?
Pre-COVID, I think COVID, as I mentioned, I think that demonstrated when you take some of the barriers down, what can actually happen. You shorten time frames, you get people wanting to work together. I think that showed what was possible. So I think we need to probably take some of the learnings out of that. And the danger is sometimes you move on too quickly and don't maybe do a, for want of a better word, after action review to see what were the learnings out of that and how do you replicate those and don't lose them.
How do you collaborate with the NHS in terms of approaches? I mean, there are different NHS boards and so on.
Yep.
Do you have to approach the boards one by one, or...?
It would vary company to company, if you know what I mean. So it varies typically. Hugely. As ABPI, we have quarterly meetings with Health Improvement Scotland, and through that meeting, there's a lot of information in exchange. You can get passed on what's happening with industry and at a board level. But invariably, it tends to be an industry collaborating with a board. I think the beauty now, as I was saying, the Centre for Sustainable Delivery, there is this desire to do pilot type projects and then scale them up quickly, which I know Dame Hannah is very keen to promote.
Given you said that post-COVID there's been an increase in this collaboration, it's still difficult to get a feel for how significant this collaboration is. How is collaboration just one or two odd projects here and there, or is there actually something that's...
Well, I think it's collaboration at different levels. So if I take, you take ABPI, we engage with Dame Anna from the outset, because as much as, we all represent our industries, if you like, from a Scottish perspective, a lot of the members of ABPI in Scotland. So we're very keen on things like the Lord O'Shaughnessy report and everything else to make sure how do we collaborate to bring that, research into Scotland. So there's this kind of cross-pharma work going on at that level. But then if companies have specific areas they want to collaborate on in certain therapy areas, then that's down to them to drive through a board discussion and engage. So you see it at different levels.
It seems to be hard to actually get your hands around what the total scope of this is.
It's not easy. It's not easy, that's for sure.
Thank you, Mira.
Thank you, Michael Chapman.
Thank you very much, Claire, and thank you to the panel for your contribution so far. It's been an interesting discussion. I want to explore a little bit more the notion of the infrastructure that we need in Scotland that the Golden Triangle clearly has and we don't. And I suppose Georgie talked very specifically about it in relation to clinical trials, but I want to think more broadly than that. And we've had reference to the Tayside regional deal and equivalents elsewhere. I suppose, Adam, in the report, you talk about the regional dispersal or the geographic dispersal of the industry being good and having a network across Scotland. Does that apply across the different elements of what we're talking about here, or is it specific to, there's good research capacity in some places and not elsewhere, there's good innovation in some places and not elsewhere, that kind of thing? I'm just trying to understand the stratification within that statement about good dispersal.
Yeah, thank you for that question. Yeah, so we touched on that in a report, that the geographical split of pharmaceutical jobs, if that's what you're referring to. Yeah. The pharmaceutical industry predominantly employs in North Ayrshire, which we highlight as being widely recognised, quite deprived area, mm-hmm. facing many challenges in Scotland. And also the second highest is in the Highlands, and it's predominantly GSK manufacturing. Right. So these are highly skilled, highly paid As we also outlined in our report, across all deciles of pay, the manufacturing of pharmaceuticals in the UK pays above the living wage and well above average. So this is more to do with the manufacturing of pharmaceuticals jobs that are in North Ayrshire and the Highlands. So just that definition plus some of the pharmaceutical R&D counts within that definition.
Okay, there is maybe not a disconnect, but there's a distinction between that dispersal and what we've been talking about, the focus in institutions around, you know, the Edinburgh focus, Dundee, Aberdeen, those kinds of things.
This is more the split is more focused on the predominantly manufacturing of pharmaceutical jobs in these
And I suppose that then means there's also a comment in the report, and you mentioned it in the summary at the start, around the value of skilled jobs. And I think there's that connection that I think many of us will try and see of investment in R&D and the sustaining of skilled jobs, making sure that those don't get sucked into an equivalent of the Golden Triangle in Scotland, you know, the Central Belt. How do we ensure that we've got the infrastructure that doesn't lead to that sort of sucking into another, it won't be a triangle, will it? It'll be a line.
It's a great point, and it's really important that these jobs, well split across the whole of Scotland, that they are in places like North Ayrshire and they are in rural communities as well. So it's important that, for example, the GSK manufacturing plant in Irvine, these kind of places stay open and continue to employ those in the local area, because it's not just about jobs in these places, but they have, and it's not just about the kind of economic impact, but the wider impacts that having these jobs in those areas that have experience. If you look at the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation, income deprivation, employment deprivation, some of the highest child poverty rates in Scotland. So, in terms of the both economic impact, but also the wider impact, keeping these jobs is really important, not in the kind of Glasgow, Edinburgh zone, but in places like North Ayrshire.
Mike, I don't know if you want to comment on that, given what you've said about the lack of or the mismatch of investment in certain stages, certain times of
yes.
the process.
Yes, thank you. I think it's really important that every region, every area, every city that has the intellectual capital to create spin-out companies has the infrastructure to absorb those spin-out companies. Because if your spin-out companies are kept close to the founding scientists and the technology platforms that created them, the companies themselves get the fastest opportunity of growth. And therefore, it's important that we don't just have, for example, I'm not picking on it, but don't just have the Edinburgh Bi-Quarter. No, everything should go to the Edinburgh Bi-Quarter. It doesn't really work. Yeah. You know, Dundee spin-outs need to be next to Dundee University, Aberdeen spin-outs need to be next to Aberdeen University, and so on and so forth. And the distribution of excellence in the fundamental research, or the opportunities to create spin-outs, is across the whole of Scotland. I mean, the big three are Dundee, Glasgow and Edinburgh. But, you know, Aberdeen is absolutely spectacular in biologics. It has a real sort of, you know, specialist niche. And then, you know, St Andrews, Heriot, Watt, Strathclyde and Stirling in aquaculture. You know, they all have these zones of excellence and expertise. So all of them need to basically have the opportunity to keep their fledgling and actual spin-out companies close, to give them the best opportunity of success, being close to the founding scientists and the technology platforms that created them. So that's what I think is necessary. We're starting to get that infrastructure now with the Aberdeen Biohub, the Dundee Innovation Hub, which will be opened next year, and so on. Bi-Quarter has always been there. Glasgow has some significant capabilities for spin-outs as well. So we're beginning to level up that playing field. Enough, probably not, but sufficient, you know, but some sufficiency. So I think, and that will keep the distribution of the R&D base wide, and I think that's really important. I would agree with you that what we don't want to do is just to see that suddenly collapse into one place.
So I suppose building on that, and maybe this, you know, we've heard a lot about scaling up and the importance of different types of investment, a VC into that, and the public public investment to bridge gaps. Is there something that we also need to be thinking about? And we've heard it in this committee before in other contexts and other sectors around scaling deep and scaling out. And George, you talked about, you know, how do we stop people doing the things that they've always done? You know, and what is it about the culture change or the culture that we need to change that isn't just about money, but also how do we, what else do we need to do to ensure that we get the roots? Because essentially what we're talking about are those setting down of deep roots around the spin-outs, so they do stick. And that's not always about scaling up. And we don't talk about scaling out or scaling deep. And how do you help us change that conversation? And what do you need from us to help change that conversation?
I think we need to make Scotland a really attractive place for investors to invest in. And also it's a 10-year project this, but we need to accrete a talent base that we don't currently have. We have the talent in the science and the ingenuity, but what we don't have are the C-suite talent. You know, the CEO, the CSO, okay, the CFO. They all live in the southeast of England. But one thing the pandemic has taught us, and it's been a fantastic revelation actually, is you can leave them there. Mm. You can keep your R&D team, which is the majority of the jobs in Scotland, and the C-suite folk can carry on living in the, my opinion, ghastly southeast of England, and and come up and down to their Scottish assets. And actually, in doing so, over time, we'll accrete them to Scotland because it's so much nicer place to live. But that's a 10-year project. But it used to be seen as a barrier. People would say, "Oh, well, you'll never get investors to do anything in Scotland because all the C-suite people are in the southeast." But actually, it turns out they can work virtually. Right? Yeah. That's one thing the pandemic has taught us. Everybody can work virtually. And it works very well from that point of view. So that's much less of an impediment now. But I do think over a 10-year project, as it were, we need to accrete a critical mass of that talent set as well as the fundamental scientific R&D talent.
Okay, thanks. George?
Yeah, no, apologies. Just to add to that, I think, you know, this, the innovation hubs, but also the fact of Scotland's size, it's quite an advantage, really, because if they can act as... I think there's Ones for Scotland approach that's been pushed out at the moment is really, really positive because, you know, if you get that data infrastructure right, then companies will... go back to this tipping point. I think we will get to that place where we're not far away from it at the moment, you know. So I have a duty of care to kind of bring people in my organisations, other organisations up and put showcases on to show people what Scotland can bring to them.
OK.
Thank you. Colin Smith.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good almost afternoon to the panel. The Scottish Government is considering the creation of a national pharmaceutical agency to improve links between life sciences and the NHS. They've described it as a possible front door for the life sciences community. Do you think this agency is necessary, and if so, what should it do?
Yes, so we've heard a lot of conversations about it. We've actually invited Alison Strath along to our access and value meetings. I guess we haven't really debated it in any great detail at the moment because we're still waiting to sort of see some of the detail on that to what you know what its purpose would be, what it's going to do, what would the opportunities, what would the threats be. So, in short answer to your question, we haven't had a big debate on it. So
is this something that appears, therefore, to become from the government rather than from the industry itself?
Say that again, sorry?
Is this an initiative that appears to be coming from the government, or it doesn't sound like it's coming from the industry itself?
Yeah, it's not nothing that we really were proposing at the moment, no.
Okay. Don't know if Sir Mike has any comment on
that. It's really the other end of the business chain. You know, my expertise, such as it is in the early innovation and creation of spin-out. George's expertise is at the other end, which is how do you get final products engaged into the national...
There's nothing negative about it. It's just we haven't had a ongoing debate about it yet. You know, I'm sure when the time is right, we have a great relationship with Alison Strath, the Health Minister, etc. So I think, you know, we'll be brought in, we'll have discussions. We've never had an issue with that. So back to the point I made earlier, I think in Scotland we're fortunate that way that we're very much round the table and can have these discussions. So I just think we don't know which.
Well, the government described it as in its early scoping stage, so I think you've very much confirmed that for us.
Yeah, correct.
Okay, thank you very much to the witnesses.
Very brief final question.
We are running above time, Mr. Stewart, if it is very...
I think it's an important one.
I'm sure it is.
Convener, thanks. George and others have mentioned Spain's ability to carry out clinical trials in a more efficient way. If memory serves me well from the pandemic, Spain itself also had a very high vaccine take-up rate. Is there a scenario whereby COVID and some of the conspiracy theories on it, some of the conspiracy theories that there have been before, caused difficulties in certain places in recruiting people for clinical trials? And is Spain an advantage because there is a, it seems to be a trust in the government and the infrastructure in terms of managing to do those clinical trials?
I think
we're doing well, so I'm not sure that correlates over.
You know, good observation. I couldn't make the correlation, but what I would say about Spain is, because IQVIA, who based you know, in Scotland, obviously, and Gary White, who's the deputy chair of the industry leadership group from Scottish Life Sciences, I asked him, well, why Spain? What are they doing so well? And his only answer was that across each of the regions, they're really cohesive in terms of how they do it, so they're all talking to each other. So I think that that's back to the points we made earlier, that Scotland's small enough to be able to do this. And if we can get our data structure, our universities, everyone just working together, then I think, you know, hopefully there's a great landscape here to move it forward.
I don't know if anybody else wants to come in.
Spain's also invested hugely in their public health services, so they now have the capacity to bring in clinical trials, whereas previously they didn't.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. That does now bring us to the end of this morning's session. Thank you to the witnesses for an interesting discussion. I now bring the meeting to a close and move into private session.